Oh, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, come move here in this place. Lord Jesus Christ, Almighty God, we worship you. Sing it again with me. Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, come move here in this place. Oh, Jesus Christ, Almighty God, we worship you. Sing it again. Oh, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, come move here in this place. Oh, Jesus Christ, Almighty God, we worship you. Do it again. Oh, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, come move here in this place. Lord Jesus Christ, Almighty God, we worship you. Lord Jesus Christ of heaven, come move here in this place. Lord Jesus Christ, Almighty God, we worship you. Jesus, 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 a name above our names. Lord Jesus Christ, Almighty God, be glorified. Lord Jesus, 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 a name above all names. Lord Jesus Christ, Almighty God, come move here in this place. Oh, Jesus, 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 name above all names, Lord Jesus Christ, Almighty God, we worship you. We worship you. Lord Jesus, we love you. And we worship. Jesus, 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 a name above all names. Lord Jesus Christ, Almighty God, we worship you. And Jesus Christ, Almighty God, come move here in this this place. Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, come move here in this nation. Oh Jesus Christ, Almighty God, we worship you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Ibrahima masete, Ibrahima erebeshe, Ibrahima imbrido son rinambeke koranatea. Abromon se prende pritaba otobo ishish. Arabo kotasa deyatisht. Let the working of the living God overwhelm you now. He's here. He's right there with you. He's in you. Ha! Libero sata y golomonje kairomon prandefika. Libera si prota. Let the Spirit of the living God take you from where you're at into the place He'd like to lead you to. He'll do it right now. All you gotta do is yield just a little bit. Hallelujah. 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 Just a little bit. Just yield just a little bit. It doesn't take much yielded to Him. And things will just begin to transition. The atmosphere of your life will begin to change. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You won't even care about the speaker system and the sound of it. You won't even care. You won't care about whether or not your car works or not. You won't even care. Whether or not you even had a place to sleep, you wouldn't even care. Whether you're alive or whether you're here in prison, in the body, or whether you're up in heaven. And you'd rather be in heaven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just say, Paramasaya. Just yield yourself to Him. He's here and He's moving right at this very moment. He's moving. He wants to move through you. Hallelujah. 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 Well, you know, I've been talking to the Lord and just telling Him the way I feel about things. And I know that He feels the same way that I feel about it. I don't really understand what all He's going to do to change it. I've got a bit of an idea. But I was just talking to the Lord about how that it's about time that religion no longer have first place. It can like have fifth or sixth place maybe, but it sure can't have first place, and how it's run ruin in people's lives so much that they don't even know how to move in the Holy Ghost. They don't even know how to flow in a place of relationship with them that can last all day long. It can last through the night, through the next day, through the night, through the next day, and through the night, and on. And religion. And then it's blocked the way so that this nation has not been able to see Jesus. And we're just praying, believing God for a great outpouring of His Holy Spirit. But I know how it's going to come. It's going to come because there's a people prepared unto the Lord. There's a people who know how to flow in the Holy Ghost. There's a people who know how to give themselves to the realm of the Spirit, who just simply know how to be yielded. They're not all self-contained with natural thinking and circumstances and what about this one, what about that one, how I'm going to make sure I'm going to accommodate them. You know, many people, they got a long list of people that they got to please while they're trying to please God. Ain't going to work through those people's lives. Going to work through your life. Going to work in people's lives with total abandonment. It doesn't matter. All you've got to learn, you know, you just got to learn that, you know, you know that you've stepped into the door of His presence because joy has overwhelmed you. If you not, look, if you're not If joy's not overwhelming, you haven't even stepped in the door. I'm not saying you haven't been born again. I'm not saying you haven't been saved. I'm just saying you don't know how to yield to God. I'm just saying you don't know how to cooperate with the Holy Ghost, because in His presence is fullness of joy. What He's empowered us to do, everything He says in His Word, it's not an obligation, it's an empowerment to do these things. When the Lord said to Abraham, walk before me and be perfect, He wasn't putting him under obligation. He empowered him with His Word of life. He gave him divine ability to do it. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the living God. You know, when the Lord told us to walk in the Spirit, He didn't put us under obligation. He empowered us. When He told us to live by the Spirit, to be led by the Spirit, He empowered us. When He said, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision to fulfill what you would desire to do. To fulfill your own strong desires. And really, you know, that's where it all comes down in terms of if you're really following Jesus. Jesus said, I come to do the will of the Father. I don't do my own will. I'm not going to fulfill my own desires. If you're going to follow Jesus, then God has empowered us to put on the Lord Jesus Christ. I know how the King James translated it. I just disagree with their translation. They had a dualism in the concept of the way they were thinking. And it says, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision to fulfill the strong desires of your own will. To feel the strong desires of a human need. To feel the fulfill the strong desires of your earthly interest. People want to make it like it's a dual nature thing. Give me a break. That's why people don't move on with God. They all trapped. They don't know who their daddy is. They don't know who their redeemer is. Job knew who his redeemer was. And he didn't have all the privilege that you and I have of a whole Bible of testimony of so many prophets, including God Almighty incarnated in flesh Himself, God who at times past spoken to our fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken unto us by His Son, whom He has appointed heir of all things, by whom He also made the worlds. And you know, when you think about God as appointed unto Him, heir of all things, and He went and made us co-inheritors with them. And you know, tonight I'm going to talk to you about reigning in this life with Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Reigning in this life with Him. I'm going to talk to you about how wonderful it is to begin to move in faith and live in heaven now. See, if you don't believe it, you can't have it. From the very beginning of the gospel, if you don't believe it, you can't have it. He gave sonship to everybody who would believe. He came to His own, and His own rejected Him. His own did not recognize Him or receive Him, but as many as received Him, to them He gave authority to become the sons of God, to be the sons of God, as many as believed upon His name. And if you can't believe it, you can't have it. Everything in God moves in faith, works by faith. It starts with faith. Without faith, you can't please God, because you can't do anything God said unless it's faith. And faith, and first and foremost, is agreeing with God. It's being convinced. And praise God, you know, it's amazing. If I had to depend upon my own intellect to be convinced, I would never be saved. But the convincer came. God, the Holy Ghost, is the convincer. He's one who would convince us of the truth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then I have to be convinced. And I remind myself that I'm convinced. And when everything is opposed to me, I go, no, I'm convinced. Yes. When something comes, tries to rise up and argue with me, I say, no, I'm convinced. Hallelujah. Someone tries to inspire you to think more about it. You just can't think, people. Come on, admit it. And there's none of us that are very good thinkers. Come on. Now, not when it goes so far. Come on, quit acting like that you made all A's in school, okay? Forget about it. I know there's some people here who did, but by and large. And that really doesn't even matter, because what's that? That's just something somebody repeated to you over and over again. You just told them back what they said. What's that? Give me a break. You can be seated. Hallelujah. I decided I'm going to think God's thoughts. Tonight, I'm going to instruct you in thinking God's thoughts. So, you know what an amazing thing to me is? People get in a quandary about what to read in the Bible. You're going to be kidding me. Open the Bible, read anywhere. It's like they're in a quandary. Where do I start? Listen, people, I want you to understand something. You know, I spend a lot of time in the Word of God, and I've never opened up the Bible and not got richly blessed. So, you know, I really believe that people ought to start at Genesis 1:1, read all the way through Revelation 22, 21. I believe that, and I do that. But I also systematically study the Word of God. And, you know, somebody said, you know, I'm always talking about people about finding their threshold of reading the Word, studying the Bible. And can you read the Bible in 90 days? Easy. Can you read the Bible in 60 days? Yeah, really relatively easy. 30 days? Well, you're going after it. But then there's times I spend all day on one single verse of Scripture. All day. Somebody says, how is that even possible? Because I really wrestle with what really the appropriate word really is to translate that from an archaic Hebrew word or from, you know, basically an abstract Greek word. I just wrestle with it. And then what I'll do is I don't just sit there and think. I read everything I could get my hands on. And I mean, I have this huge library so I can read things that people wrote back in the 2nd century and 3rd century and 4th century and 5th century. I just work my way up to modern day. Sometimes I work my way backwards, and I have certain people that, you know, I love to read after. And, you know, I was showing Tim the other day, showing him a particular dictionary that I have. Just takes one word, but it will define one word for you, but you've got to read through about 30 pages. Hallelujah. Some of you were just looking at me. But at any rate, so I said, where do you find the time? There's a lot of time. There's 24 hours in a day. It's a lot of time. You got all day Saturdays. Praise God. This basically, we got all day Saturdays, and we got all day Sundays. Praise the Lord. You got nights. I used to get up in the morning, go to work, get up in the morning about 6 o'clock in the morning, go to work. And then as soon as I got off of work, you know what I did? I went to the Bible. Because I told the Lord, I said, Lord, as long as I'm going to work a secular job, I'm going to give you just as much time as I give to the secular job. And, you know, I wasn't really thinking right. What I was doing is, you know, I just felt like, well, I need to go ahead and support the church because we planted a church so many years ago. And, you know, I have wrong notions and whatnot. But the bottom line of it is, I'm just telling you, people always trying to try act like they can't find the time. You're just lazy. And as long as you're lazy, you're never going to really find much. You're never going to really have much. I mean, you could be standing over top of a great gold mine, a motherload of gold. But unless you get in there and dig and work around, you're going to be as poor as you were before you found it. You know, you're going to have to dig. You're going to have to, it's hard work. It's hard work, I tell you. And, or, you know, there's a vein for silver, but unless you get in after that thing, start pickaxing the thing. Digging for silver is tough. I mean, and especially if you basically back 100 years ago, 200 years ago, with a pickaxe and a shovel. My goodness gracious. But it was worth it because there was riches to be had. I want you to understand that I'm talking to you about a privilege, not something about religion, not something about a ritual, not something about a have to, but I'm telling you about a relationship that begins to be developed in your life. I'm going to tell you right now, I do not normally ever, it's rare, do I ever study to preach a sermon, ever. I never wanted to get in that rut with God anyways. I saw so many people in that. The only time they really got earnest about the Bible, really started going after the Word, is when they had to preach. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to be religious with God. I'm not going to do that. I just give myself to the study of the Word. Now, let me tell you why I do. Because there is a glory of His presence there when you're thinking about Him. I'm going to say this. I'm going to tell you something. There is a great fortified power that is given to you when you're thinking about what He said and your mind is occupied with His Word. All these other things suddenly come at you and they have no value. I mean, I've discovered over and over again, if I'm in a situation where maybe I'm overwhelmed with a circumstance, maybe I'm even overwhelmed with a temptation, whatever it is, I just go to the Word of God and I just plug in over here and just start saying, listen, well, I'm going to hear Father's voice. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can you? I just opened up to something so beautiful. Hallelujah. For as much as you saw that a stone was cut out of the mountains without hands, and it had break in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, and the silver, and the gold, that great God hath made known unto the king what shall come to pass hereafter. The dream is certain, and the interpretation thereof is sure. God's going to come and destroy every kingdom upon the face of the earth. He's about ready to come, and He's about ready to establish and set up His eternal kingdom that is so wonderful and so glorious. Hallelujah. I'm getting ready. This next book that I'm going to have Charisma published for me is going to be on the millennial reign of Christ. And I first thought, well, you know, I'm going to do it fictional. And then the Lord kind of helped me understand, you don't need to do it fictional. I'll give you enough information to make it just perfect. And so, you know, some of the stuff is going to be clearly an opinion and going way out there with just some little bit of information. But God's given us enough information on what it's like to be in the millennial reign of Christ that you could pretty much set up the whole thing for 1,000 years and pretty much lay it all out of what it's going to look like and what it's going to be. But I want to talk to you tonight about living in heaven right now. Hallelujah. How many in this place that you can honestly say that you know that the Bible teaches that we are to live in heaven right now? Would you raise your hand? That is really good that many people know, because a lot of people in church, they don't know that you can live in heaven right now. And so because they don't know that you can live in heaven right now, they just go with whatever's coming down the pike, whatever idea, whatever stream of interest, whatever influence, and they're more involved in sin than they are in righteousness. And then they want to convince me that I need to be involved in sin like they're involved in sin. And now they're going to accuse me of having some kind of false doctrine because I won't agree with their, you know, with their wrong thinking. I'm going to live over here in a place where I've been born again. God has placed his nature in me. He's given me a new heart and he's given me a new spirit. And he's put his spirit on the inside of me. The Holy Ghost is Holy Ghost, God. The Holy Ghost, the Spirit of holiness, has come to live on the inside of me. Christ Jesus, the Lord, the King, the one who's exalted above every power, over every principality, over every government, both spiritual and natural, lives in me. Come on, give me a break. And God the Father, hallelujah, has come to make his dwelling on the inside of me, and it didn't get finished yet, okay? Having been made the temple of the living God, a fit dwelling place for God to inhabit, my heart being the place where he set up his throne, my mind and my heart, my thinking, my spirit and my soul being the realm that he is filled with all of his divine glory, he done come along and baptized me in the Holy Ghost and fire. On additionally to that, not only did he come and baptize me in the Holy Ghost and fire, but the Holy Spirit is with me and Jesus Christ is with me. And I'm going to tell you right now, he's with me with everyone who will believe, even unto the end of the world. And everywhere we go, he confirms his word with signs and wonders following. And you can do whatever you want to do with God's word, but if you don't agree with God's word, I'm going to tell you right now, you can't have anything that he said, but you can have man-made religion and live in everything that is opposite of what God said. And unfortunately, we find a lot of people that live that way. And it's just a sad, sorrowful thing that holds back revival and the move of God. When you begin to exercise this wonderful realm of faith that God has given to us, which is a divine ability to do God's works, then all of a sudden we find ourselves now empowered to live out a supernatural life of signs, wonders, and miracles, to begin to be trained by God how to speak and it comes into being.
Amen.
How to command with divine authority, and every power of darkness has to obey a voice. But if you're not willing to be trained, if you're going to continue to go ahead and compromise and live in your own opinion and speak out your own words and curse yourself with your own mouth and tell us about how sick you are and how your mama was sick and your grandmama was sick and you expect it to be worse than you are now, then all you're going to do is continually to inherit the whirlwind that you're sowing to. But all of a sudden, when God is allowed to fill your thoughts, you know, the beautiful thing about the new covenant is that the Lord said by all of his prophets, he said in the new covenant, he would come and he would change the fundamental nature of man, and he would write his words and his statutes and his judgments upon our heart and upon our mind so that we would do them. And of course, you know, that's repeated also in the New Testament, Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 10 and Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 16 and many other verses of scripture that are corollary to that. But I'll just leave you that with those two, because if you'll just meditate on those two, those things will begin to encourage you. You know, if all of a sudden you're overwhelmed by circumstances and you're compromising and you're thinking about allowing ungodly things in your life, just read the first epistle of John. You know, I'm actually getting ready. We're getting ready to publish the epistles of John. I was going to wait and publish it with all of John's writings, the Gospel of John, first epistles of John, the epistles of John, and the book of Revelation. But I didn't want everybody to have to wait till I was finished with the Gospels, because I got back into the Gospel of John and editing it and said, my goodness, I've got to camp out here. I don't want to rush with this. And it's just so easy to sit, you know, just so wonderful when you don't have to drink your tea fast. You know what I'm saying? Huh? You just get to sip it. You know, you just enjoy it, relax. It tastes a lot better. You can taste more flavor there. You know what I'm saying? I like to sit back and take my time and, you know, just work on a verse of scripture. And because I write a commentary on the entire Bible from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. And I encourage you to do the same. Why don't you write a commentary on the Bible? Get yourself involved. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to be busy. And you're going to be blessed by it. Hallelujah. And I'm way ahead of you, so I'm going to finish before you do. And I give you all of my resources. I'm happy to do that. Because anything that you begin to do when you goal set, and you begin to say, I'm gonna do things to get me in the Word. Yes. I'm going to do things. I want to wrestle with these subjects. I want to understand the mind of God. I want to understand the mind of the Christ. You know, I used to think, the greatest thing that could happen to me is I could begin to function in the mind of the Spirit. I want the mind of the Spirit. I would think about the mind of the Spirit in this context of supernatural things like the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom and the discerning of spirits. And that's important and that's good and that's wonderful. But the Lord began to help me understand that the mind of the Spirit and the mind of Christ was coming to the knowledge of God, knowing what it is that God thinks, how He thinks, what He's purposed, what He's willed, what all He says, what all He's commanded, and that is discovered in giving yourself to the Word of God. Not just some little Bible studies, not just some little promises from heaven, not just every once in a while spot checking and see where you're at, or going to your favorite verses of Scripture. You know, there's been many times I try to tell, I come up to people, and you know, and I know that the Lord wants to unlock them into a whole other dimension of relationship with them. And all they do is they just step back and they quote their three verses of Scripture. And they're imprisoned to their three verses of Scripture. Because I'm going to tell them now, look, God wants to baptize you in the Holy Ghost and fire. And they're going to step back and they're going to be imprisoned. They're going to quote their three verses of Scripture and say, what about this and what about that? Or I'm going to tell them, God wants to show you how to live in the glorious liberty of the sons of God and not be constantly overwhelmed with sin. And then they're going to retreat and they're going to go back to the little cage and the little imprison of their three verses of Scripture that they know that they've taken out of context. And they won't listen. You see, you hear what I'm saying to you? And what happens is that everybody, to some degree, can act the same way on certain issues of your life. And God wants you to start thinking like He thinks. And that's going to be contrary to everything any human being's ever told you. Unless he was speaking by the Spirit of the Lord as an oracle of God. But in your culture, in your society, everything that you've learned since you were a little guy, blah, is going to impose itself upon you. What have you learned how to do? Most people learn how to push other people around, shove, fight, argue. Just complete chaos. Huh? With this exercise their own opinions, tell what they think, and their thoughts hadn't gotten them anywhere anyways. I mean, my goodness gracious. Come on, you know what I'm saying? You know, if you've made a couple of $1 billion with the way you think, I mean, somebody ought to stop and just listen to what you got to say a little bit about how you did that. You know, it could have been an accident, you know, but, you know, probably there's something really there. Most people are sitting around just scraping by. And God wants to give you wisdom and show you how to prosper and show you how to do it right. If somebody comes along and they understand how to do this, you should be willing to listen. God has come along and He knows how to do this. And we should be willing to listen and start doing it His way, exactly how He said to do it, rather than doing it our way. You know, I think one of the most important verses of Scripture is for people to grab a hold of to begin with, if you want to understand that God has called you and I to be able to live in heaven right now, is you just grab a hold of this verse of Scripture in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 13. How many of you right now, just look at me for just a minute, how many of you right now you can quote Colossians 1:13? Would you raise your hand? Because I'm going to probably call you to quote it, okay? Just spot checking. Raise your hand if you can quote Colossians 1:13. Listen, I want to encourage every person in here to memorize the Bible. And it may start with one verse, but you know what? That's one verse towards memorizing the entire Bible, okay? Then when you memorize two verses, you're two verses in to memorizing the entire Bible. You're on your way. You memorize no verses? I mean, come on, you haven't even got started. I mean, how far are you in? But especially give yourself to those fundamental things about walking out this ministry of Jesus, this life of Jesus, these blessings of God. Understand this. Father said it over and again from Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, all the way to 1 John 3:17. He said that only those who do the will of the Father will inherit eternal life. He made it very, very clear. He says there's a lot of people that says, Lord, Lord, but only those who do the will of the Father are going to step in and hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. Everybody else is going to hear something else. And then all the way to 1 John chapter 2, is it? Did I say 3? 2, verse 17, where he says, the world, that's all the state of humanity, and their lust of the world, which a lot of people are fascinated by, and this is what's captivating. You're either captivated by heaven or you're going to be overwhelmed by the lust of this world, because I'm telling you, Satan is a good trickster, okay? He's a good deceiver. He sets up all kinds of interests that people just seem like that they've got to have, from the shiny gold objects to the riches to all the kinds of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. And then you're not captivated by heaven. I'm going to tell you right now, Satan is going to take and fill that void, and he's going to captivate you. He's going to captivate you. But he says that the world and the lust thereof will pass away, but they that do the will of the Father abides forever. You got that? Yeah. You have that? Well, then fundamentally, the most important thing for everybody who's really serious with God, not playing patty cake games with God, not playing, you know, just posers. There's a lot of posers in every walk of life, whether you're snowboarding, skiing, surfing, in business, you know, whatever. There's posers. People acting like they're doing it, they can do nothing. You know, they're just posing. Because, you know, they've never really anteed up or paid the price to do it. Are you with me? Yeah. They want to be there without ever paying the price. And Father has paid the price on our behalf. And he just simply wants us to agree with him, because that's where faith starts. Faith that we must have if we're going to move with God. We've got to first and foremost agree with him. We've got to be convinced that what he says is true, and who he is God. And being convinced that he's God, and that what he said is true and certain. And that he watches over it to hasten it, and not one of his words can fail. And we agree with it, and we trust him now with our lives. Huh? See, convinced that he's God, I agree with him. Now I trust him that he loves me, that he likes me, that he has my best interest in mind, that he's going to be alongside of me, that he's going to come and help me, he's going to strengthen me, he's going to empower me, he's going to establish me, he's going to perfect everything that concerns me, he's going to be my provider, he's going to be everything that I need, he's going to be my protector. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, I got my, you know, 40 cal here, whatever, you know, what? And people, preachers pulling guns out of their briefcase. I'm like, I don't need that. I have a bigger protector than you do, man. Hallelujah. So I said, well, what if somebody breaks into your house and shoots you? Then I'm going to go to heaven. Hallelujah. I'm going to another dimension, and I'm happy to go there. But I'm not going anywhere till Papa says so, because, see, I personally believe that nothing happens unless God gives his approval over it, and he allows it, because I believe he's absolutely in charge. I believe God's absolutely in charge. I believe nobody even winks unless God gives permission. Hallelujah. The church has become deist and didn't even know it. They just act like, you know, they've been indoctrinated with science, and the sun comes up in the morning because the earth revolves, you know, around the sun and the planets and the moon and all the other stuff that they don't understand one bit of it. They just saw a little model in physics class. Are you with me?
Yes.
No, the sun comes up every morning because God commands it so. Hallelujah. Hey, I'm going to tell you right now, cows calve because God says calve. Hallelujah. Hey, he opens up his hands and he feeds and supplies and sustains all things. Praise God. You walk with God, my goodness, you won't cast the fruit before it's time. And Satan won't be able to get an advantage on you, because God has set limits and bounds on Satan. And if people give themselves over to Satan's reign, then Satan can impose things upon you. But still, there's bounds set upon it. Go out there and just stare at the ocean. Watch the waves come in. Huh? Find out what tide it is and to dare the wave to come near you. Huh? So I bet you can't touch me. And then mighty waves coming from, you know, thousands of miles away. Can't touch you because God set the limitation and he set the boundary. He so said the same thing in the realms of the spirit. Hallelujah. But as far as us being able to move in him and walk in him and live in him, people, I'm trying to convince you that God has set no limitation, no boundary. It all comes down to what you're willing to believe, how you're willing to function with him, how you're willing to be developed by him. He's not going to give you something that's going to, you're going to blow yourself up with, destroy yourself and a bunch of other people with you. So he's going to prepare you. He's a good dad. He knows, look, he says, this is a lot of power over here. There's a lot of divine ability over here. You got one, you know, you got one group of people on one side of town praying that it will rain, and another group of people on the other side of town praying it won't rain. Now, well, God's confused. No, God's not confused at all, because the reality of it is Father is going to have people that understand what he's doing, what's going on in his mind, and he's going to have people also that he's given authority to decide whether it's going to rain and whether it's not going to rain. And you're the person, I hope, that is going to allow Father to prepare you under such a realm. And if it's going to happen in your life, then you're going to begin to understand some fundamental things here. And Colossians 1:13 is one of the first things you really need to grab a hold of. And if you don't know it well enough to say it out, then you're not living it. You know, I could tell you pretty much what my vows were that I said to my wife right at 32 years ago. Not because I memorized them, but because I gave myself to doing it as my vow. It wasn't just something off the top of my head. I was going to come up with something pretty. Hey, somebody help me with something romantic, you know, refer to the, you know, dictionary, because there was no website at the time. There was no Google. No, what's in my heart? What's in my heart? You know, what's in my heart? What am I willing to do? What does God say to do? That's the best, you know, reference book to refer to anyway. How does Father say to do it? Did I give myself to it? And now I don't have to memorize it. I do it. I live it. And right here we understand fundamentally about salvation. We see something here that we're going to grab a hold of, because Father wants us to live in heaven now. Look at this. It says, he has delivered us from the power of darkness, and he's translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. I'm telling you right now, if that's not heaven, I don't know what is heaven. Because Christ Jesus is never going to be anywhere other than heaven. If being baptized, immersed down into the presence and the glory of God is not heaven, then what is heaven? If being baptized in his fire and his presence, of being filled with his presence and with his divine glory is not heaven, then tell me, what is heaven? Hello? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
I mean, the Lord Jesus said, I mean, think about Jesus' life. You know, Nathaniel comes to him and he says to Nathaniel, you're going to see angels ascending and descending off the Son of Man. And what is he talking about? He's talking about the reality that here he is living in a heavenly realm. He's talking about the reality that he's standing in a place where he sees Father at his right hand, huh? Standing before him so that he should not be moved. That Father has given you think about it. Father has given you and I the ability to function in his divine power and glory through a oneness that he's given to us with himself. Now, if you don't believe this, if you're not convinced of it, if you don't agree with God, if you're not convinced that God is who he says he is and that this is his word, you can't even begin. But if you're convinced that God is who he says he is and this is his word, and now you agree with what his word says and you trust him with regard to establishing you in those things, you trust that those things that he said really is applicable to you and not just to me. Some people say, oh, well, that's the pastor. It's so easy for him. Oh, it really it is, huh? No. I went through and go through the same thing that everybody else goes through. Hello. I remember, you know, we have this property. It has probably 80,000 square foot of building. It's 6 acres of property. We had a place before we were here. It was, you know, and this place is worth $15 million. And we had a place before here down at the Naval Training Center, which was even bigger. Okay. But yet I remember a time when it was huge because I was going to step out in faith and I was going to rent a building for $325 a month. $325. Whoa. Are you listening to me? $300. 325 big ones per month. I'm stepping way out in faith now to do this thing. Listen, it starts right there. It was just as big then as it was when all of a sudden we find ourselves with a $35,000 a month budget. You know, it's just as big. I mean, understand, people, you can either back off, back away, turn to yourself, do it your own way, or you can just go on this wonderful adventure with God and let Him prove Himself to you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, I'm like in it right now. I'm always in it. Father would take us from one dimension to the other in terms of how He begins to empower us to believe, empower us to move with Him. Right now, you know, they're doing a security check with me, on me in Cuba, so that I can meet with Fidel Castro. First and foremost, I'm going to pass that security check. I'm going to get vetted properly. I'm going to meet with Fidel Castro. I'm going to pray with Fidel Castro. I'm going to lead him to Jesus. I'm leading the kingdom. And somebody says, wow, I mean, you know, why do you think you can do that? I don't think I can do it. I know I can do it. God has breathed that into me, just like He's breathed other things into me. And those demonstrations of His power, those demonstrations of divine glory, find itself in its expression to begin with just in how you're walking this out with God. If you don't believe you can live in heaven, then you're living in hell. Yeah, you are. To one degree or the other. I mean, it's not full-blown hell yet, but it's kind of close. You know, people getting tormented, gnashing of teeth. They grind their teeth at night because of stress. Huh? Weeping and gnashing of teeth going on all the time. Are you listening to me? So you say, well, no, I'm not really in hell. I'm in earthly realm and earthly interest. Well, how's that working out for you? I mean, how good is that? Because I'm going to tell you right now, that isn't good according to what the Lord said. That isn't good. All you're going to do is find yourself living out a life that in the end, the Lord's going to say, has nothing to you. He's going to say, depart from me, you that practice sin. I do not know you. Anyone who practices sin, because that's what God says. And that's not what men say. That's not popular doctrine. That's not the ideas of men. But God's word is very definite, very clear on it, okay? And so the reality of it is many people are trapped in that realm simply because they're not willing to agree with that which Father has made available to us. He's made available to us this realm where we understand, wait a minute, I've been delivered from the power of darkness, and I've been translated into the kingdom of the dear Son. And understanding now that I, in this perspective, now understand Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. How many of you can quote Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 6? Raise your hand. Okay? Basically, same group of people. You should really know these verses of Scripture, because if you don't know them, then you could be deceived. Somebody could come along and tell you, you know, one of their three verses of Scripture that has imprisoned them, so that you could have maybe one or four to, you know, one of those to help imprison you that much more. Rather than being liberated and stepped into the glorious liberty of the sons of God, now having a provision of heaven that is supplied to you in such a way that the presence and power of God floods out of you like rivers, as Jesus described. Amen. And, you know, the reality of it is when you begin to walk in this fellowship, when He's walking in you and you're walking in Him, when you stepped into a place with Him that you agree with Him and says, wait a minute now, here I am in this situation that I'm in, and yet the Lord says that the same glory that He received from the Father, He's given it to me. So I'll take glory now. I'll have glory now. I thank you, Father, for glory now. And then all of a sudden, that begins to develop in my life, and that's all that I choose. That's what I'm going to have. Because I'm convinced, I agree with God, I trust that it is for me, and because that happens, a supernatural realm called faith begins to work in my life. Faith is the divine ability to do the works of God. Now, I'm telling you how this works. Listen, God is no respecter of persons. Hallelujah. You know, people, listen, right now, crowds work for me better in Asia and in Africa, especially Asia, than they do here in America. But that doesn't make any difference. It's just a matter of time till we bust through this thing. Right now, forgive me, I'm busy changing culture. I'm busy changing mindsets. I'm busy saying a lot of things that most or many Christians don't even agree with, because they would rather be conformed to the world rather than being transfigured to act like Him. Listen, if God has set juxtaposed to one another the world and heaven, and He says, don't be conformed to the world, then what is left? but be transfigured by the renewing of your mind. Where do you think you're going to end up if you're transfigured by the renewing of your mind? If you're not of this world or in this world, then where are you at?
Heaven.
So the Lord says in Ephesians chapter 2, 6, you listening to me? Hello? God's going to try to get you to start thinking like he thinks. See, even in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy chapter 11, the Lord says, just obey me, keep my commandments, do what I say, grab a hold of my thoughts, meditate on them day and night, and you will have days of heaven on earth. And many people want days of heaven on earth.
Yes.
Well, I'm glad that almost everybody raised their hand, because if you didn't raise your hands, you are an idiot. Because what you are saying by default is that you want hell. And so I can't help you. You're an idiot. You've deceived yourself and been deceived. And I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to get it. And you might be all boisterous and think you've got something going on. You got nothing going on. You're just less than a little gnat on it, you know, on a piece of whatever. Less. God is almighty. You can't stand up one day in his wilderness. Not one day. Not one moment. It's true. I mean, you get scared to death, we take you out in Big Sur. Sit all bold in the presence of God. You humble yourself before the Lord. Huh? I doubt you would go for the walk with the lions in Livingston, Zambia. And they all tamed. Every once in a while, however, one can walk. Act up, so they got a disclaimer. You have to sign if something bad happens to you, it's nobody's fault but your own. That's true. People are all arrogant and proud and lofty in their thinking. They did nothing. Done nothing. All arrogant before the presence of the Lord. People, come on, man. Father is inviting us into something so wonderful and glorious. You know, I don't have a problem with people who don't know God not responding. The people who say they know God and they don't respond, I got a serious problem with that. You're in the way, man. You're in the way. You're the problem. You're the whole issue of why things are so messed up. And people just like that, okay? And it provokes me. Reality of it is, I'm talking about glorious and holy things, and I know Father's disposition about it. Father's disposition is this. He simply says, listen, you sow to the flesh, you're going to reap a whirlwind of destruction. In the day of your calamity, I will laugh at you. He said, you sow to the Spirit, and you sow to the Spirit, reap everlasting life. A wonderful, glorious, the God kind of life, filled with all the abundance of every good thing. People are so arrogant, they're so defiant. Now, as soon as something starts happening, as soon as it gets a little scary, a little Halloween thing goes on, you know, spooky, spooky, they all got the back of their hair standing up, on the back of the neck. What a coward. Hey, listen, you stand before the presence of the Almighty God, you just don't even know it. Reality of it is I pray in Jesus' name that you'll come to a place where you know it, because I don't want to see anybody remain in their blindness and their darkness and their ignorance. God doesn't want that either. And so what's going to happen? What's going to turn the ship? There's going to be a people who are going to believe what God says and begin to move in it. I'm going to tell you right. Come on, people.
Yes.
And when the most lay pratafaya, the Lord has laid out all these wonderful things, we would do well if we take heed unto his word as unto a light shining in a dark place and agree with what God says and think this way. And then all of a sudden, I'm going to know what Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6 says. So go ahead. You've heard me quote it to you many times. You'll recognize it as soon as you get there, right? But it's important that you just not only recognize it, because I'm not going to be around you all day long going, Ephesians 2, 6, Colossians 1, 13, John chapter 17, verses 21 through 23. You could take a recording, Anne has on her iPod and she has on her iPhone. She listens to the Bible all day long. I mean, basically, you see your plugs in her. You know, see that she's listening to worship or she's listening to scripture. That's good, because ultimately that's good. That's where your mind really needs to be. But there are certain topics that you want to grab a hold of and you want to live in them, because it'll overthrow everything Satan throws at you. It'll overthrow everything. See, as the light begins to shine, it shines into every dark crevice on the earth. That's the light of light, Christ Jesus. He shines into every dark realm. There is no darkness that has been able to stop the penetration of this light. Every man is without excuse because the light of life has come and shined to every single human being. Amen. And people die in their sins and they go to hell because they're stubborn. Because they're full of themselves, because they want to believe a world according to the way that they think it happened. I mean, you know, come on, people. That's pretty lame. That anybody would be so arrogant that they think that they're that smart, that they know that much. Come on, give me a break. You know, come on. Let's just go ahead and understand here that these things are way too high for us. Yes. And Father, in His mercy and His love, has come giving us insight. And so let's just go ahead and agree with Him. In Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 6, as Scripture says, and He's raised us up together. Say, He's raised us up together.
He's raised us up together.
And He's seated us together.
And He's seated us together.
In the heavenly realm.
In the heavenly realm.
I mean, that's the reality of it. The reality of it is, when we're talking about the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, Jesus rose from the dead. He ascended up on high into a heavenly realm, and there He was seated with the right hand of the Father. And He's telling you and me that through this wonderful work and miracle of salvation, that He has also seated us together with Him. And it's not some kind of esoteric thing. It's not some kind of positional thing. It's reality. But you and I have to go, we're going to have to bo sarabataya. You don't mo le pekista. You go na mo rimandi palatushi. Brafateno mo kasi pala. You go to borina. You got to the borishika. That is heavenly. That is right there. That is a heavenly language. You have to agree with God. It's a heavenly language. It is something that belongs to the realm called heaven. It is supernatural. It is where the word of knowledge comes from. It is where the word of wisdom comes from. It's where the discerning of spirits comes from. It's where the working of miracles comes from. It's where the gift of healing comes from. It's where the gift of faith comes from. It's where prophecy comes from. It's where these tongues come from. It's where, hallelujah, it's where the interpretation of tongues comes from. I've got a wellspring. I've got a river. I'm baptized in the Holy Ghost. I'm baptized in the fire. I've got this wonderful spirit of wisdom and revelation, the knowledge of Him. I've got joy unspeakable and full of glory. I've got peace that passes understanding. I've got love that goes beyond all knowledge. I've got His goodness. I've got His godliness. I've got His fellowship. I've got His relationship. I've got oneness with Him. All these things is what God is saying. And once again, if He says, don't be conformed to the world, what is He telling you to be conformed to?
Heaven.
I mean, come on, listen. You know, how many of you can you just quote? You know what Romans chapter 8 verse 29 says? You got it. If you raise your hand, you know what Romans 8 29 says? You know, it's good, about the same number of people. More of you know what Romans 8 29 is. It's just you need to write it down. And just, I want you to get this, because what I want you to grab a hold of right here in this wonderful realm of thinking that God has established in your life is what He is thinking. It is the mind of Christ. It is the mind of the Spirit that then allows us to begin to place a demand upon ourselves to function in the divine authority that He's given to us. It brings us to a place of a yielded state towards Him, so that all the blessings that He's blessed us with in a heavenly realm is accessed by us, because it's available. It's already done. It's not something that you've got to earn. It's not steps or levels like mysticism that you go into. It's encounters. It's dimensions. It's not levels. It's dimensions. It's not levels. It's dimensions. See, God talks about dimensions. Height, breadth, length, depth. That's not a level. That's a dimension. Are you with me? Height, breadth, length, depth, that you may know the love of God which passes knowledge, the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and be filled with all the fullness of God. And He says that you may know what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth. That He's talking about the dimensions of all the fullness of God through these encounters. How does that happen? I agree with them. Hallelujah. You know, when I'm dealing with sin and temptation, I don't really think about, you know, hell's the consequence, and, you know, it's opening up a door to participate with demon spirits to do it. I'd just rather think about the realms and give myself to that place of the realms of heaven that I'm living into, and I'm not interested in visiting hell. I mean, I'm just like, I'm captivated by this relationship and by the goodness of God and by the blessings of God and by the empowerment of God. I'm not thinking, oh no, if I do this thing, God's going to take all of his blessings from me. I wasn't even thinking about that at all. I'm thinking about the relationship that I have with him. There's so many more positive things to live in rather than to constantly be responding to the negative. I mean, God placed within, before Adam in the garden, all of the things that he was allowed to do, and there was only one thing that he was not allowed to do. And you know, it is kind of like almost if it were on the same basis. He just says there's one thing you're not allowed to do, sin. All the rest is yours, man. Some people go, what? What's the rest? Because their whole life is consumed with the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and pride of life. And that's all they know. But there's a whole universe God created. There's more with him than are with them. There's more things to do. There's more things to be blessed with, more exciting things. This is the abundant life, not some kind of life. A bit of life. It's abundant life, not a bit of life. It's eternal life, huh? Not temporal life. All the interest that could possibly captivate. You know, there's things that are beautiful. There's things that are interesting. There's things that are arouse your curiosity, spark an interest. But you know what? It's all going to get old, ugly, and die. It's going to get moldy. I promise you, I don't care how shiny it is or pretty, it's going to get moldy. But there's one thing that doesn't perish. It's eternal. It's in the heavens. It's beholding that glory and that life that he's given. If you'll set your affections there. You know, the Lord just places it like this. He says, get all your affections and thoughts and interest in heaven. Now, how many of you know where that verse of scripture is? That's good. There's more people. Come on, there's more people that's got that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We'll go to that one in Colossians here in just a minute. I want you to move into heaven. I want you to pack up all your stuff. Can't pack it all up. Get it all put together. Amen. With this heavenly van. Let's get out of here. Come on, let's move in. Let's don't think about, oh no, man, I left my special, you know, book of memories back there. Forget about it. Let it burn. Let it go. Hallelujah. Leave it. Pack up, lock, stock, and barrel. Be over in the realm of the family of God, seated in a heavenly realm with God. Hallelujah. In the heavenly place. Now, I'm going to come to Colossians in a minute, but I want you to real quickly go over with me into Romans chapter 8, verse 29. And I want you to understand, once again, the Lord, it's all in this whole thing of being separated unto him. He separated us. You know where he separated us to be? He said, come in with all boldness by the blood of Jesus Christ into the Holies of Holies. Where's that? There is a couple of people that got this, and they were able to actually step over into a heavenly realm. People like Mariah Woodworth Eder. She got it. She was able to visit. She was able to move from this realm into the heavenly realm and talk with the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Many of God's saints have been able to see the angels that are with them, because God has entrusted angels to be with us in this realm. He has. He's made angels ministering spirits for us, the heirs to salvation, helpers, you know, going, getting our stuff, carrying our bags. Somebody said, hey, can I carry your bags when you go to Kashmir? Don't need a bag carrier, I got an angel. He's taking care of it. Don't need it. You know, come on. I mean, you just understand. It's just having a different perspective on what your life really looks like. And your perspective is now the Word of God that defines it for you. You are convinced of it. You agree with them. You know you can trust God that what he said is for you. And it's not just for a pastor and a few other people who can go around the world and do this stuff. It's for you. It's for every single one that you've been baptized with something far glorious than cloven tongues of fire. It's got bigger than that. It's bigger than a rushing mighty wind. There's an increase of His government of which there is no end. You've got to start thinking different. You must be renewed in the spirit of your mind to begin to think a heavenly realm, a divine thinking, the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit, what God has done for you and me. When we were delivered from this darkness and translated into the kingdom of the dear Son, you tell me where the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ is. It's heaven. And He's King over all things. You know, in the Hebrew language, there is no word, specific word, for universe. It is always said like this: Hashamayim v'haaretz, the heavens and the earth. Heavens and earth is how God, Hashmayim v'ha'eretz, heaven, Shemayim, and earth, Eretz. It's His, and He feels it, and yet He lives in me. Ha, seprokane palamapi. Things start going bad. Sickness starts trying to impose itself upon you. Financial issues try to harass you. Ha, I just get all captivated. The one who fills the universe, He now dwells in me.
Yeah.
He and me and I and Him. He and me and I and Him. The one who fills the universe, He now dwells in me. He lives in me. He walks in me. He speaks His word through my lips. Ha. Listen, I just challenge all of you to do this, because I see that every one of you guys, you're called to begin to live big for God. Do what I did when I was young in the things of the Spirit. I would take the Bible, I would take only verses of Scripture, and I would write whole stories, and it would never be anything than the verses of Scripture. I would weave verses of Scripture together to tell a complete story. I practiced it for years. It is a beautiful thing to do. You will first start spending a lot of time finding the next verse of Scripture to make the next point, to make it one complete story. And you know, one way that you can do it is you can begin to write out the story of the gospel and how it applies to your life. And then you can go and you can start looking up the verses of Scripture to prove it and replace your sentence with a sentence right from heaven. And you work at that, and it won't be long. And you're going to start walking in the mind of Christ or the mind of the Spirit, because that's thinking like God's thinking. That's God's thoughts. That's those things that He's spoken, His word, that you and I are going to have to begin to agree with Him. And the beautiful thing of it is, it doesn't take a lot of talent and memorization. It really is the Holy Spirit bringing to our remembrance everything that He's spoken. When I was in undergraduate school in college, I used to say I practice learning how I develop my ability to memorize really quickly. And what I would do is I would practice. First it would be like I look at a verse of Scripture, then I would just look at it, glance at it a little bit, then I would turn away and I would quote it, and I would miss about half of it. And I kept working that. I kept working where I could glance at it, turn away, and see it. And I kept asking the Lord, Lord, I want You to give me the ability to remember Your word. I want, if there's any place I want total recall and a photographic memory, is I want to be able to glance at Your word, close my eyes, and be able to read it. And doing it that way, the Lord developed that in me to where that I could just look. And before long, it wasn't just glancing at one verse. It was several verses. And the Lord will do that. Because why? I was desperate to start thinking God's thoughts, because that's the realm of this wonderful place of living with Him in divine power and divine authority. Yes. Hallelujah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. If I can get you to go to the Word. When I was a little person, little guy, you know, when I had a bad dream, and I go into my parents' room and I said, Mom, can I please sleep with you? And she, you know, I said, I just had a bad dream. She would hand me the Bible and she'd say, take the Bible and put it under your pillow and everything will be fine. And so being a little 3-year-old, 4-year-old, Mom said so I took the Bible, went back to my room, I stuck it under my pillow, I laid down, I was fine. But what happened is it began to develop within me, listen to the wisdom of the Spirit, a comfort area. Where do I go for comfort? Hallelujah. Where, as I grew, where do I go for comfort? Where do I go for instruction? Where do I go for guidance? Where do I go for strength? I go to His Word. It's food. It's the true manna from heaven. The eternal Word became flesh. I get to handle the Word of life by the things that He's spoken right here in His Word. I want to get this. I want you to get it, because then it will overthrow those thoughts that come at you. Because the bottom line of it is, if you're being assailed with thoughts and you don't have the Word of God to stop it, you're overwhelmed. It's the only thing available. That lie that you just heard. It's all that's available for you. And it's taken you, because Satan in his craft, he's like a terrible salesman. He will demand. He will impose it upon you. He's like a tyrant. He's tyrannical. He will demand it. Girls, you're going to have to start behaving. One of you sit on one side, one of you sit on the other. Come on. Come on, work this thing out. Lord Jesus, I'm helping. I'm grandfather. Romans chapter 8, verse 29. Here's what the Lord says. He says, for whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate. How many of you believe that God foreknew you? How many of you believe God predestinated you? It's right there, is it? You may have a different concept and idea of what that means, because He's foreknown everyone. He's not willing that any should perish. It's the light that lights up every man that comes in the world. If I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. The grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. God's not willing that any should perish, but everybody should come to salvation. Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord, anyone, everyone. Those are the words that are used concerning the general population of God's foreknowledge and predestination for anybody to come into this general plan that God has made for us through His only begotten and Son, the Word made flesh, to carry away our sins, so that you and I now might be a new creation filled with a divine nature, united together, one in oneness with Him. But that faith has got to be developed in you. It's got to grow and mature, and it's developed in you, and it grows and matures in you because you confront the things that oppose that with that persuasion, with that consecration. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Huh? Because that's where the real test is. And that's why the battlefront of what, you know, Tim has been saying all week when he's talking about the weapons of our warfare, which are not carnal, but mighty through God, understanding that the two most powerful offensive weaponry that we have is the Word of God, the sword of the Spirit, and with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. That's fire. Word. Prayer. I mean, when you begin to ask God, you can ask God, Father, get him. Stop him. I feel sorry for anybody who fights the people of God. I feel as sorry for them as I do for people who fight God. I feel so sorry for people who do violence against God's anointed. I feel as sorry for them as those who would do violence against the kingdom of God. I mean, my goodness, when God is on your side, people, come on. What a protector. What a provider. Hallelujah. Harabakashi lipi tarabahush. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to just tell you a story. Dear friend of mine, who this is his story, this is his life, is watching right now. And he was in prison, and he was blamed in prison for something he never did. And he got what's called in prison green-lighted by the leaders of the gangs. And when you're green-lighted, that means anybody can take you down. Everybody has to get permission from the head of the gang to take anybody else down, even to beat somebody up, basically. He got green-lighted, and everybody was talking about it. He was the only person in that prison so full of the Holy Ghost, leading Bible study, just radical for the kingdom of God. And, you know, the devil set this thing up, and I mean, it was bad. And I'm not going to tell you what all it was. It's pretty silly. I'm going to tell you what it is, because it's so juvenile. But, you know, this is adults. This is all they got. They're in prison. They're locked up. Some of them are locked up for life. But somebody poured Kool-Aid down the TV, and the TV blew up. And when the TV's gone in prison, that is the worst violation. So they got green-lighted to get killed, basically, okay? Now, let me tell you right now what happened. This guy, Hubashilimaka, as a lopronasia, as just a little child of God who believes that he's standing in the presence of the Lord and that God sees and beholds him, that his ears are opened unto his prayer, begins to lift up his voice to the Lord and say, I'm yours, Lord. Then people say, you need to pack up your stuff. You need to roll up your gear. Because if he did, he'd roll up his stuff and he could go up to the warden and get transferred out because his life be threatened. He said, no, I'm not doing it. I'm not backing down. I'm not going anywhere. Hallelujah. Isn't that good? I'm protest God. I'm prove him kind of thing. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful story. So all of a sudden, this guy shows up to him in just old prison attire, something that was back in the, I think he said 50s, 60s, old prison boots, old prison pants, old prison shirt, old prison t-shirt, old prison hat, old everything. Stuff that is not even around anymore. Not even around anymore. And furthermore, he's been in that place for many years and he's never seen this guy. And this, what was it? Angel shows up in prison garb. I'm telling you, because that's really what it came out. Because he basically said, hey, listen, I heard what they've done to you. I've heard what they've said about you. I see what they're about to do with you. Let me pray for you. Says a simple prayer. He's never seen the guy ever again. Huh? Huh? So he's leaving the yard and getting ready to go now into the place where everything can go down if it's going to go down. And he's standing in front of the door and he's thinking, all I got to do is go roll up my stuff. I can go to the warden and I can get transferred out of here. I'm going to be fine. Yada, yada, yada. And he says, no. There's a doorknob. Now, scripture is beginning to flood his mind. Come on now. The things that he's preached begins to take hold of him. He opens up the door and the first thing he sees is the two primary gang leaders. And they're like, hey, man, everything is cool. Nobody mess with this guy. We just found out we're getting a new TV. It's better. We don't want anybody messing it up. We don't want anybody messing it up. And it was they never got a new TV. It was a rumor that God started. Nobody said that. It just like, Lord, shut the whole thing down till everybody can find out he didn't do it. I'm telling you, I don't care where you're at. This is a great story. Thank you, my dear brother. It is a great story. He's wherever you at. If you're willing to believe his power, he's right there in the midst of the worst kind of temptation, the worst kind of addiction, the worst kind of frustration, the worst kind of challenges. He's right there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What really makes the difference is when you and I take a step over and we realize that we're with him. Not just that he's with us. And whereas we're sojourning in this life, in this world of toil, all of a sudden realize, wait a minute, I've been seated together with him in a heavenly realm. I've been translated into his dear kingdom. I've been empowered by him. I'm living in a dimension of heaven, so much so that the Holy Ghost has baptized me, fills me, is alongside of me, is leading, is guiding me, before me, behind me, on each one of my sides, my right hand, my left hand. Come on. Yeah. He encamps around about me. He's always before me. Come on. He's speaking to me. He's leading me. He's preserving me. He's protecting me. He's keeping me. He's establishing me. None of my steps shall slide. My goodness gracious. It has got to be convinced over here. Hallelujah. Woo! Don't look. Those that he foreknew, he also did predestinate. Are you still reading? Because I got it right here. Those he foreknew, he also did predestinate. That they may be conformed, that they may be conformed, that they may be conformed to the image of the Son. Hallelujah. The image of the living God, the image of Christ Jesus, the eternal God, the living Word, the King of heaven, the King of kings, the one who everything must obey, for he is far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion. Hallelujah. Come on, people. This is a realm of faith. You can't have it unless you're willing to move in the realm of faith. Somebody says, oh, I just wish I had more faith. Hold up. God's given you all you need for where you're at. Now it's time for you to be convinced, start agreeing with God, trust God, start moving with him, and let it be developed now. It didn't take Stephen long. It didn't take Stephen long. He started off with a measure of faith just like everybody else. It wasn't long, and they said he's full of faith. Yeah. Who did mighty signs, huh? Yeah. He did mighty signs and what? Miracles. That's what happens when you start living in the heavenly realm. Huh?
He's just standing there. They're stoning him to death. He looks up and says, I see Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father. He's living in heaven realm. You start living in heaven realm, all of a sudden the veil's taken away. You start seeing realms of heaven. That's a realm of spirit, wisdom, revelation, where you get to start seeing what Father's doing so you can do it with him. Come on, man. You know, I want to do this. And well, why don't you start agreeing with God's word in your adversity? Why don't you agree with God's word in your adversity, and then you can start having more? Why don't you agree with God concerning the things he said about you instead of doing it your own way or doing it after your own mind or thinking, or rather, worse than that, we could just say what it really is, your own will. Pursuing your own interest. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision to fulfill your human desires, your self-interest desires, your earthly desires. The Lord wants us to be conformed to that which he predestinated and foreordained and empowered us to do through the new creation, the miracle of salvation. Then on top of that, being baptized in all the realms of his fullness of his glory, the same ministry, the same anointing, the same baptism, not a different one, the same one. So that you and I could begin to now live out a different kind of existence, and through it, we now give testimony to who he is. And that's why the rest of this verse of scripture says that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Huh? So now if I'm conformed to his image, I'm now laying hold of the fact that I'm co-inheritor with him. See, I'm reigning right now in this life by Christ Jesus because he's reigning, because I'm co-inheritor with him. God created, God who spoke to our fathers by the prophets have in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he is appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the world, whom he's appointed heir of all things, and you and I are co-inheritors with him. It's something that he's already entrusted us with. It's something that he's already made a living reality through oneness. But until you and I begin to take the challenges of oneness, stand up in the face of those challenges and say, you are a lying, stinking devil from hell. You are just nothing but the thoughts of men. You only hold dear those things that men think. Get behind me, Satan. I'm obeying God. It's never going to be lived out. It'll be a fairy tale. It'll be a fantasy. It'll be fictional. Hello. People, God's looking for some folks that are going to rise up with him. Oh God. Hey, that's it. God is raising up a mighty army. It's oh God. It truly is. It's a passionate plea that needs to go off in our spirit. It says, Lord, I want to see this. I want to get this. This is no playing, no games. This is no little religious, you know, patty cake program. Come on, people. This is no games. This is reality. This is heaven and hell. Yes. Amen. This is truth against lying. Yes. Father has purposed to reveal all of his glory through you and me as brethren, firstborn among many brethren. He, the firstborn. Firstborn from what? The dead. Hallelujah. Firstborn of humanity into the divine realms of glory. Father, the glory you gave to me, I've given it to them that they can be one just like we're one. Father, just like you are in me, I will be in them and they will be in me. A oneness. And you're going to face the challenges of life with this thing. Because every time we turn around, people are turning to the arm of flesh. And they're making, in other words, provision for the flesh. Because, you know, what happens is they said, you know, King James set that verse of scripture up in Romans to make it sound like, you know, we're given over to an old nature and sin nature and allowing iniquity. Well, you know what? It could be defined as that, but that's a gross definition. And reality of it is, it's more refined than that. It's not about whether or not you're choosing to walk with God or choosing to walk with the devil, choosing to be moving with the spirit of holiness or choosing to move with a demonic spirit. It's really more refined than that. Are you choosing to do the will of God or do your own will? Are you choosing to walk in what he's demanded for our life and believe the extraordinary things that he said about our life, of who we are and what we can do? Or are you willing to just rely upon your own human instinct
Are you listening to me? Because that's not far from an animal. Huh? Are you hearing me?
Yes.
It's not far. Because men do things that are worse than what animals do. Instinct. Father wants us to get out of that realm. Huh? And be led by Him. Be moved by Him. Be filled with His passions. Where does that come from? Feasting on the Word of God. Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. Listen to the authority of the quoting of the Word, the speaking out of the Word. Hallelujah. This is how we deal with it. This is how you're not going to be successful any other ways. You're not going to see people born again, transformed by the power of God until you're willing to let the Holy Spirit show you how to speak a proper word in due season, a proper word at the right time, a word that is specifically applicable to their life. And it's not your word, it's His word. God's word won't return void. It will accomplish, hallelujah, that word which goes forth out of His mouth will not return unto Him void. But what happens when the word that goes out of your mouth is the word that goes out of His mouth? And what happens is now we can say the word that goes forth out of your mouth will not return unto Him void. Huh? But it will accomplish those things which He has ordained, intended, demanded. Huh? What happens when I start speaking that way? What happens when you start speaking that way? In the midst of that mountain just will not budge. I told that mountain, get out of the way, woman. Well, you need to get a little bit rougher with the thing. You need to get a little bit more intense about it. You need to become a little bit more passionate about it. You need to speak a little bit louder. That mountain's probably hard of healing. Hearing. It needs a healing. Okay, it's hard of hearing. It needs a healing. And it just keeps shouting because God says there's a grace to do it. Yeah. Hallelujah. And you know what I found? As I finally moved into a place in God, I told the mountain to go and it's gone, whether it's still there or not. And I was going to leave it. Huh? Come back later. Yeah, I told you it was gone. It was gone. Because so many things happen that way. If I sit there and wrestle with it, all I'm doing is wrestling with my own doubts and fears. I said, go, you're done, out of here, bye. And I move on, right on with God, hallelujah. Somebody said, you're not ignoring reality. No, I'm accepting reality. Reality said whatever I said was going to happen, so it's a done deal. I'm not going. My reality is not what I perceive with my eyes, it's what I read in the Word. My reality is not what I heard with my ears, it's what God spoke with His mouth, hallelujah. I'm going with that. You go whatever you want to go with, I'm going with that. It's working for me. It worked for everybody else I heard about in the Bible because Abraham called those things which are not as though they were, and it happened. Yeah. Hallelujah. Come on, man. And that's why you will hear me say a lot over and again now that I'm in this throw with Castro about how that I'll be meeting with Fidel Castro here in a few months. Is there, maybe even in a few weeks, you know, because I'm going to say it over and over and over again with everything else trying to say it can't happen. I'm saying, oh, yeah. Somebody said, oh, I heard he was about to die. He ain't going to die till I'm there. He's going to live till, tell him he's living till I come. Don't tell him that. Maybe he won't let me come. So he can live longer. Hallelujah. Come on, people. Don't sit there and look at me. Like you're not going to do this. So don't sit there and look at me like you're just going to continue on being the blah that you've been up to this point. Huh? You know what was the worst thing? Worst thing when you were a kid. Worst thing. Huh? A bottle rocket that was a dud. Huh? A firecracker that didn't go off. Huh? One of those M90s or whatever. Remember those big guys? And it was a psh. You're like standing back going, man, just a walk. And it was like, psh. Like, what? And you're afraid to get close because like, what did the abuse go? It was just a psh. And then especially if you paid your hard-earned lawn mowing money for that thing. Give me a break. I didn't want to be that. I'm not going to stand around and watch you be that when God has filled you with so much divine power and ability. Yes. And you don't think it's going to mean that with opposition? I'm going to tell you right now. Satan hates the anointing. And when he sees anybody starting to look like that they're convinced and starting to look like they believe and starting to look like they're moving with God, he's going to come at it with everything he can up to the limitation of which God will allow. And he's given you the ability to agree with him to know His Word, to speak out His Word, to stand in that realm in which He told you to stand, so that now He can make you strong through it. Hallelujah. That's why the devil has to go when I say boo. So I don't even have to go boo. I have been in situations where I just waved my hand, just shook my hand like this, and demon spirits by the multitudes went out of people in a mass evangelism situation. Just wait. It's beautiful. You're like, whoa, this is cool. True. And that's what Father wants to do through you, but you got to stand up against it. I mean, come on, people. Come on, I'm not talking to you from yesterday. I didn't fall off the turnip wagon yesterday. This is not my second rodeo. I started 35 years ago pushing this thing. Come on. I'm more convinced today of what God is going to do in Southern California than I was 35 years ago when I had all these people prophesying. In fact, I just recently had some men of God saying the same thing by the Spirit of the Lord, but even on a more intense scale. That was said to me 35 years ago, that was said to me 30 years ago, that was said to me 25 years, 20 years ago, 22 years ago. I mean, come on. It's just over, because God hasn't changed His mind. It's just like we want it to happen now. Now, quickly. No, you need to just let it go. You just need to put trust in the Lord and know that it's already established in heaven and Father's preparing you unto every good work, and be faithful in what God has given to you, but be faithful in the context of where you're supposed to be. You're supposed to be in the heavenly realm, receiving all the spiritual blessings in the heavenly place, seated together with Him in that place of divine power and authority, in every way constantly being conformed. If I'm going to be conformed to the image, who is the image of Him? I mean, Jesus Christ, the express image of God. I'm going to be conformed to His image. He has all authority. He has all power. Anything He asks God to do is going to happen. Father, I know You hear me, that You always hear me, but I'm going to say it like this right now, just so everybody else knows I'm talking to You. Lazarus, come forth. I mean, all power and all authority. And He's placed that in you and me. And He says to be conformed to Him. Think about this. Listen to me. If you and I are to be conformed, exactly what does that look like tomorrow morning? Because I'm interested in what's going on now, but I'm more interested, I'm talking about now, right now, I'm talking to you in a way that's supposed to have a practical application when you wake up in the morning, that you are determined to say, okay, I'm going to act like Jesus. I'm going to put on the Lord Jesus Christ. What He did, I'm going to do. What, the way He lives, the way He walks, the way He functions is the way I'm going to live. I'm going to walk. I'm going to function. It's something He's given to me. I'm not earning it. It's not a level that I'm stepping into. I'm interested in another dimension of His of revelation of who He is by an encounter I want to see Him. And the reality of it is He's here right now, because He's very interested in me. Very good. I was getting ready to say, I don't know about you, but I do know about you. I'm glad some of you said that. He's very interested in me, and He's very interested in this church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I know I can feel Him standing, going, you know, in talking to me, saying, now you're not going to back down from Kashmir, right? Because too many people have backed down from Kashmir. You're not going to back down. You're not going to back down from Cuba, right? You're not backing down from Azerbaijan, right? You're not backing down. You're not going to preserve your own life, because that's ultimately where it comes. It just starts with the little small things about your car not starting in the morning, your toast burning, you know, your TV broke, or whatever little thing it is that's constantly irritating you. Nobody listened to you. No one said hello to you. I mean, it didn't seem like God answered your prayer because you asked the Lord for it to rain and it didn't rain, or whatever it is. Because it really does come to, you know, just trivial things. They really have nothing to do with reality. Your bird died and it didn't raise from the dead, so it blew up your whole image. You know what I'm saying? Come on. You made something important that was absolutely not important at all. Come over here and let me slap you. Huh? It's because he's going to develop these things in your life to worry that you don't preserve your own life. Your life is not interesting to you anymore. You're captivated by him.
Yes.
I'm captivated by him.
Amen.
I'm captivated by Jesus. My life's not interested in me. My life isn't interesting to me anymore. If you lose your life, you can have his life. You hold on to your life and you're going to lose what you got. It's just terrible. You got to live with you and you got to be a blow it. And you got to sit around at 70, 80 years old saying, I blew it. You know, it takes you to like 70, 80 years old to even start thinking, get any wisdom, and like, I totally blew it. Now you just become an angry, cantankerous, bitter person because you blew it. Hard to live with now. Nobody wants to come around you because you're always grumpy. What a terrible existence. Come on, I'm not going to sit around and watch this happen. Because ultimately, the Lord works this thing out in your life so that all of a sudden he says, okay, I want you to go to Kashmir. You don't even think about your own life. It doesn't even matter. You just walk in there just as confident as you can be. Hallelujah. Frasati alabokashile makaya. Hallelujah. And you watch Father open up all the doors as he did when we were last in Kashmir. I'm telling you, when I walked into Kashmir, the Taliban shot 6 policemen. I believe it was. Correct me if I'm wrong. Something like that. How many policemen got shot? 3 people. 3 policemen. I knew I was off. 3 policemen got shot by the Taliban. I don't know how many Taliban there was. There's those guys. And the tanks were rolling up and down the street with their mounted 50 millimeter caliber on the top, and they're just sitting there looking mean. And up and down the street. But I got there, I put my stuff, I went to the hotel, and I was putting my clothes in the hotel closet, and I really felt like I was putting my clothes in the closet at my home. The Lord gave me the nation. I just felt, I felt he gave us the nation. Then everywhere I went, people are like, we'll do anything, we'll cooperate, we'll help in any way. Hey, huh? The Lord was, we were fascinating them, weren't we? Everywhere we're going, they're going, wow, whoa, wonderful, come on in, kind of thing, you know? Hey, just the Lord saying, please do this on my behalf. Please, I promise you, if you'll go for me, I'll stand there and I'll confirm my word with great signs and wonders. I'll preserve your life. I promise you, I'll be there with you. I promise you, you'll see more of me than you've ever thought you could know of me.
Amen.
Because you're not willing to preserve your life. And it's no problem when you're already in heaven. It's a very small step from this life into the next. Hallelujah. One day I was just crying out to God. I was in the middle of revival. It was a great move of God in the 90s. And listen, people, don't be dull. The Lord is always setting us up for great moves of God. He sets us up for great moves of God. And everything doesn't have to be going your way. God set me up to be right center. Listen to me. God set me up to be right at center stage in the move of God that he planned in the 90s. Just about every single person that God raised up in that move, that sovereign move of his spirit, became close friends of mine. And I'm telling you, I was no one in ministry in terms of popularity, obviously, small church, and most of the people in the church didn't like me. Okay? But it doesn't matter. It doesn't even matter.
Huh? My children loved me. A few other people loved me. Some tolerated me. Other people didn't like me. They were just there because friends were there. You know, but the bottom line of it is they didn't understand anything about what God was doing in my life and what I was being faithful to. So it doesn't matter what your circumstance it is. It doesn't matter how people vouchsafe you. It doesn't matter the accommodations of men, the recommendations of men. What it's all about is, are you being faithful to God? Are you allowing Him to prepare you so you can be equipped to step in, to move with Him as He does what He does. Amen. Sovereignly. Because it's about ready to happen again.
Amen.
Don't be dull. God has, you know, oh, I missed out on a sovereign move of God in the 90s. I'm lost out. No, I promise you. I promise you. There is another wave a coming. Somebody said, well, I live in revival. I live in the move of God. Don't get me wrong. I live baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. The Lord told us to be continually filled with the Spirit, which is the same as to say to be continually baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. I'm taking Him up on that.
Yeah.
That isn't some obligation for me. That's something that is a treat to He's supplying. That's a feast that He's prepared. Hallelujah. That's a table that He has set. That's a provision that He has given. All I'm going to understand is how to move with Him. Oh, and that's simply being convinced, agreeing with Him, trusting that it's for me.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And He supplies supernatural faith to have it. So I can move in faith. Because God doesn't do anything without faith. You don't know. Hallelujah. He doesn't. Moshepuranaya. Hallelujah. And faith is given to you. A measure of faith is given to you so it can develop into all the fullness of faith. Wonderful. But you're going to be willing to say, I'm not going to be like that. I'm going to be like Him. That's conformed. That's not being conformed to the world. I'm not going to be like the world. I'm not going to act like that. I'm not going to believe that. I'm not going to go with that way. I'm not going to be inspired like that. Because there is a mindset in the atmosphere. It's what everybody likes. It's the trendy stuff. It's why everybody likes to play, you know, certain games at certain time or dress certain ways or do certain things or popularity of certain people and individuals sweep a whole society because there is a mindset, an atmosphere created by the prince and the power of the air, the god of this world, an influence by the demonic. Well, there's bigger than that. There is a divine influence. There's a divine direction. There's what God the Holy Ghost is saying by His Spirit to the churches. If there's His leading, there's His direction. These open doors. You know, when I first told Tim about Cuba, he just told me, he said, and Tim, listen, I'm telling you right now, he's very Jovian and he's just sweet and just kind of real family here. I mean, he's basically in ministering to 20 to 30 to 40 to 60,000 people. That's what he's been doing. So he comes here, it's family, kind of just share with you about what he's going through, what's been happening in his life, basic principles as he's done this week. But the bottom line of it is, it's a powerful anointing of God, exploits of God. It is amazing. Watch him in a crusade. It is going to shock you. It's beautiful what God does through him and with him in the crusade. And he said to me, when I told him about Cuba, he said, I feel and sense the exact same thing that happened when God sent you to Nepal. And really, the situation is similarly set up. In 2006, the king had just given his power over to Parliament. Nepal had just gone from a religious nation to a secular nation. And God sent us in there and just the nation was blown up with the power of God. Great signs and wonders and miracles. Hallelujah. People talk about it to this very day. 2008 was even bigger. People talking about it to this very day, right now, at this time. In their big conferences, they refer to what God did. And the same thing is going to happen in Cuba. The door was just opened. The embargo was lifted. I mean, God could even use Obama.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Remove the embargo. Hallelujah. Because now I can ship all kinds of food in there for the celebration that we're going to do in the day for the children. Hallelujah. The great meetings that we're going to do at night. Raul's going to pay for everything. He's going to give us the 75,000-seater stadium for free. Hallelujah. He's going to give us transportation. He owns all the transportation. Basically, now there's a few enterprises now, people having private transportation, but for the mass majority, he owns that. He owns all the advertisement. There's no television station or radio station privately owned. He owns them all. Hallelujah. And so now we're going to blast away. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Why? I'm living in heaven and realm. I'm in charge. Whatever I bind, he will bind. Whatever I loose, he will loose. Why? Because I have been willing to embrace and agree with what he says. I've been translated into the kingdom of dear son. I've been seated in the realm of heaven with him. He's demanded I be in every way conformed to who he is and what it is he's doing, that I don't be conformed to the world, that I be transfigured by thinking differently or by the renewing of my mind to think about the thoughts that he's established in me through his word, to believe that he's fully entrusted me with his life and with his ministry, that he's empowered me with the same anointing, the same authority to do even greater works than he does. That is a heavenly realm, a heaven relationship, a heavenly dimension with authority over all the powers of darkness to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy. And nothing that Satan can by any means harm me. He does not have access to me. I can go on and on and on quoting scriptures and telling you a story. Hallelujah. And you need to be able to as well. You know, I'll just tell you that when we went in 2008 into Nepal, since I'm talking about Nepal, just a minute, because it's so pertinent to the things that I had to do in so many different ways in my life in much simpler and less challenging situations. When we went in 2008, the Maoists told us that they were going to kill us, that they were going to kill everybody that was associated with us. This isn't just a gang. This is an army. This is the Maoist army. These are veteran soldiers. This is a rebel army that has been fighting for 40 years. These are hardened veterans. We're killing you, men. You're not coming in here and spreading that influence and taking this our national stadium, and you're not going to do it. And then, and I said, no, we're going to do it. But at any rate, most of you know the story, what all happened, because many of you were around at the time. But the bottom line of it is, we got there, and when we get there, the guy who was the first missionary to Nepal, who was the director over the crusade, decided that he had to step down from the crusade because he thought it was going to be, dangerous, and it wasn't going to work out, and there wasn't that many Christians to fill this huge stadium, because he walked in the stadium and he looked around and he says, my goodness, this place can hold, 50,000 people, 30 to 50,000 people, and I don't even know 5,000 people that will come. It's because he was thinking so small. So what we did is we got the leaders of the church jumping ship, the Maoists are going to kill us. And I sat down and I started talking about all the things that God has said and all the things that God had done, because it was a miracle that we were there in the first place. It was a miracle that the nation was even open. It was a miracle that they gave us a national stadium, because it was an icon for the kingdom of Hinduism, and that's huge. And that's right now why the president of India has this huge embargo against Nepal, because he's putting pressure on them to go back to a religious state, because Nepal is their icon of Hinduism. And now it's secular, and you've got all of this. You got the Christian church radically growing into place, and they see a complete capitulation of everything that they hold dear and value. So I'm just telling you what I just quoted the Word of God, talking about all the things that God has done and how we're just here and done it and live, and it's just all good because we're His and He's ours, And we just sit there. We sat there with a lot of Nepalese with sad faces. I sat there with a lot of few Americans also with sad faces. We're going to die. Like Praying Hyde said, I'd rather burn out than rust out. Come on, man. I'd rather go up in a blaze and hang around and, and mold. Come on, man. Go up in a flame and just sit around in a mediocrity. Man, we come around that corner that night for the meeting, and we saw buses lined up coming down the street. People were so packed in the buses. They were on top of the roofs. They were hanging off the side, hanging on to windows. They were gripping like a rock climber, gripping some little crevice in the side of the bus, hanging on. The place was packed. Everybody got back on ship. Everybody who jumped ship at the end of the meeting or something, they're all dead, sitting around, but patting everybody on the back. Oh, it's all good. You know what? We can easily be overcome with the situation and blow it all at the moment of God's great event. We could have easily caved in. I mean, I have friends there in Nepal, and they were asking their leadership in various Pentecostal movements, what should we do? And they said, you can't risk the ministry and risk everybody. I mean, those Maoists, they mean business.
the Maoist, and showing their solidarity during the middle of the crusade. They were showing their solidarity and their power. They shut down every car moving in Kathmandu. The only car that was allowed to move was my van. It's true. And right now, there's at least two people in this room that was in that van. Yep. Hallelujah. Praise. There were three people in this room that was in that van. And one up in the nursery. Happened. And then the wife of the foremost general who had just died in the latter part of the war had come to an end. We prophesied the war would come to an end in 2006, and it came to an end in 2 months. And just before the war ended, the foremost general had died. His wife and the mother, his mother, became dear friends to us. And then they tried to say, we're going to protect you. I honestly, thank you, but I don't need your protection. I had other protection when you were going to kill me. I didn't say that. I just was gracious about the whole thing. Thank you so much. They want to give me a bunch of land. They want to come and stay. They still do. They want to come and visit me. And this is because it's a Nepali thing. Oh, we want to come to it. We come to your house in America and come stay with you. Come see what's happening. What you want to do in Nepal. Because I was telling them about what we were doing out at the Mission Training Center. Oh, we want that. And it was a dream then. More of a dream then. Think about it, people. It's amazing. Oh, we want to help you do whatever you want to do. And they still have the most power in the nation. And if the churches keep acting up, we'll just go over and start doing something with the Maoist. We were actually supposed to do a mass evangelism crusade in Western Nepal. God said so. But you know what? The pastors were afraid. We were supposed to do it 2 years ago. The pastors were afraid. They wouldn't do it. I said, the alliance, because I'm telling this for you, because it's happening in your life. They became afraid. They didn't want to do it. They say, no, everything isn't right now. The government is rattling their sabers. Who knows going to get thrown in jail? Who knows going to get killed? Who's going to get killed? The radical Hindus, the Orthodox Hindus, are on a mission to stop and shut down the movement of Christianity. I'm like, hold up just a second. Let's go back to 2006. How did this freedom come in the first place? Because you were willing to be brave enough to stand up and risk your life for Jesus Christ and do a mass evangelism crusade in 2006. What makes this any different? Just because you've enjoyed freedom for the past how many years now? Almost a decade now. It was 8 years by then. Oh, just not right. Time not right. They missed it. We had a shutdown. We had a shutdown what the government was doing. They became afraid. They're going to preserve their own movement. Their churches has grown. Things have gotten bigger. They've got more to lose now. That's why you need to give it all now and keep giving it all. That you never get so much from God's blessing that it's too big to obey Him now. It's too much to lose in honoring Him and risking everything. Somebody says, how can you go among the Pashtuns? How can you go among the Taliban fighters? It's no problem. I'm going there to bless them. It's no problem. I'm safe. I'm going to be just fine. I'm going to go in the power and authority of heaven. I'm not teaching to you tonight some theoretical idea. I'm telling you what you've got to be willing to embrace if you're going to be able to walk in the divine power and authority that changes nations. God has given us the ability to change nations. To change nations, to subdue nations. He's given us the power and ability to turn the armies of the aliens to flight. Hallelujah. Praise God. Can I just give you just a little bit more? I want you to grab a hold of this. Listen, today there's more than 300 million people in the United States of America. At least 10% of them, by most estimates, were in church. That's 30 million people in church in the United States of America. That many people that were willing to go sit in church and hear. In every different kind of denomination you can think of. But I'm going to tell you right now, only a very small fraction of them are willing to both hear and obey God. I want you to, you're going to have to make a transition. You're not going to have this because you just think it. You're going to have this because you lay hold on it. Amen. You're going to have this because you determined to have it. Because you refuse to think any other way about yourself. I don't care what everybody else is thinking. I'm interested in what God is thinking.
Everybody's got their critical thing, their suspicious thing, all their, you know, just saying, oh, well, that person's bragging or whatever. It's nonsense. It's agreeing with God. I'm not gonna be confined to the prison that you put yourself in. Amen. You can rot there if you want. Oh, no, thank you. Amen. Thank you. But we're here to break you out of that place, man. We can't make you. We can't make you. We can't make you. I wish I could. I wish I could run back there, tackle you, put you in a headlock, start beating you in the forehead. Huh? And that would change something. That would knock something loose in there or whatever. But they say, we can't do that. Oh, Jesus. I guarantee you, if one of my sons started acting up, I'd do that to them. I guarantee you, they started acting up, I'd tackle them, man. Daughters too. Nobody around me going to hell if I got anything to do with it. Yeah. Ain't nobody around me going to miss out on the things of God if I've got any way that I can impose myself on their will. Amen. I'm telling you, I'm asking God all the time, impose yourself on my will. Take control of me, oh God. Take hold of me. Rule me, oh God. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I want to be ruled. Amen. By Almighty God. I want it His way. And Satan comes. He comes along with all kinds of stuff. He'll come along with riches, with finances. He'll come along with various different things of immorality, try to make them look good to you like you've got to have them. He'll come along with things that would try to function or work in the realm of pride. All of that stuff is his tricks. But reality of it is we found something far more pleasurable, far more desirous, far more riches than that gold-plated, opulent-looking thing. Huh? Than that endowment of a couple of $1 billion. Far more. Somebody said, well, I'm going to nominate you for president of the United States. I said, I would never step down to such a low position. I'm a pastor. I would never step down to such a, if it was ruler of the world, I would never step down to such a low position. Hallelujah. I'm seated in the heavenly realm. I'm endowed with the authority of Almighty God. I'm reigning in this life by one, Christ Jesus. I'm now privileged to execute His will and His authority in the earth, to speak His blessings, to do His decreeing, to do His decree. I decree. I proclaim. I speak it out by the Word of God, by the Spirit of God. Trained by the Spirit of the Lord to speak it just like He says it. Because I give myself to the Word. Come on, people, listen to me over here. I was hoping that Tim was going to show up, because I know this morning he wanted to minister a little bit on decreeing things and decreeing them by the way that God said them. Because everybody I have known who've done great things in the kingdom of God have stepped into a place of decreeing, of knowing how to speak on behalf of Father, of believing that what they say is going to come to pass, of laying, not only decreeing it, but now moving with everything they have to engage in those things which they have spoken. And is it a struggle? Is it sometimes a battle, and sometimes is it fine? Yeah. Because now you decree you're going to have a mass evangelism crusade, and fine, and now you got to decree the $150,000 to take care of it and all the rest of the things that go along with it, and have to deal with the barrage of the things that Satan would try to throw at you to because of what you're doing. You're spoiling his house. And now, have you been equipped? Have you been prepared? Are you still moved by some little whimsical emotional issue, some self-interest? You know, is your mind still wide open to be intimidated by Satan, to be condemned with things that are just nothing but lies right out of hell? Have you girded up the loins of your mind? Do you understand how to throw down and cast down every assailing thought that Satan will throw at you? Do you know how to stand confidently knowing that you are preserved and protected by God even when the breath of hell is blown in your face? And if you don't, if you're not prepared, you're never going to be able to step into this realm. And so what I'm doing is I'm just laying out for you the fundamental basics of what you've got to agree with in God. You got to agree that you are 100% His. And He's 100% for you. There's a place of boldness and confidence that whatever we ask, He's going to do it. Because nothing, our heart doesn't condemn us. We know who we are in Him.
Amen.
There's therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. I'm in Him and He's in me. Who walk not after the human ability, the arm of flesh, or make any provision for the desires of the human realm or flesh realm. Human ability to fulfill it. But wholly trust in God who walk not after the flesh, human ability, but after the Spirit. I'm walking after a divine ability that I've been entrusted and empowered to have in every dimension of life. And you've got to start exercising it in every dimension of life. And for you, it becomes a helmet of salvation. It becomes a shield of faith. It becomes your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel. It becomes a girdle about you that girds together your loins. Hallelujah. Belt. Hallelujah. That girds you together. Harabokata. It becomes a breastplate of righteousness. Huh? You're not taking my righteousness from me. You might be unrighteous, but I'm not. Somebody's trying to tell me this thing and that thing about sick. I said, I'll tell you what, brother. I don't want to argue with you. You just have faith to be sick. I'm going to have faith not to be sick. And somebody said, oh, you can't say that. You're making yourself better than Him. I'm not making myself better than no one. I'm just agreeing with God. You're agreeing with I don't know who. But I'm agreeing with God. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. You have all I can tell you is you're not going to change me about faith that I'm not going to be sick. I'm going to tell you right now, because by His stripes, by His wound, I was already healed. Amen. And I can go on and on, because healing is the children's bread. Hallelujah. Mom, that is just my daily bread. Praise God. Hallelujah. And I can go on and on and on about His divine provision and His goodness, because He's given us authority. Lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. So just lay hands on yourself. That's right. And I just get Ann lay hands on me. Sometimes I grab her hand and I say, lay hands on me. Hallelujah. Prashe protakana. I don't even ask her lay hands on me. I just grab her hand and set on me. Hallelujah. Tekarishupuranif. Transition from the earthly to the heavenly. Hallelujah. See, it's no problem, because I've been raised up together with Him. I haven't received, obviously, the resurrection of the body. That's going to happen later. But I have received the inward resurrection. And so being raised up together with Him, what am I raised up together with Him? To live as a mere human being, to live as a mere man, to walk in an earthly realm, to walk after the flesh, walk after a natural human ability? By no means. You know, Paul rebuked the church of Corinth because they acted and behaved as mere men. He said, wait a minute, you're not supposed to know anybody after the flesh, but rather after the Spirit. For if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are new and all things are of God. We are heavenly people. It's a new race. We're a new race. When God called Abraham out, He created a new race. We call them Jews today. The Ivrites. Hebrews. Huh? When God brought us together in Christ Jesus of many nations, of many tribes, it's a new race. I don't care what color your hair is, your skin, your eyes, your lips, what does it matter? How tall you are, what nation you're from, what language you speak, is the new race. Bone of His bone, flesh of His flesh, one Spirit, hallelujah, with the Lord. How much more heavenly can you get? I just don't believe we're in it. How much more heavenly can you get than being one with God, being made His temple, being surrounded by His glory, filled with His glory, empowered by His divine authority, seated with Him in His place of exaltation? Now, I'm going to try to close with this one. I don't want to close because I got a belly full. I got a river full. I'll flood this place. I'll flood this place by the Spirit of the Lord. I flood this place. I mean, my goodness gracious, we all open up our mouth and God fills them, and we begin to allow the Spirit of the Lord to flood out of us. I mean, this is going to deluge this whole place.
It'd be the fountains of the deep will have been broken up, and the water will cover the sea. I mean, the water, like the water that covers the sea, will cover the whole earth, and then and the whole earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord's. The whole of the United States of America. I don't, right now, I'm really, you know, I'm going to, Ann and I've already voted. We voted for Pence and the Supreme Court. Because that's the only way we could justify it. We voted against somebody who wants to kill babies in advance iniquity. Somebody said, did you vote lesser of two evils? No, they're both evil, so there's no lesser.
Right.
We voted for righteousness. But it don't matter to me who gets in the president's office. It ain't going to change nothing. It's just going to, either way, it's going to make things worse. One's going to be uproar and turmoil, and the other one's going to be more legislative iniquity. It ain't going to make a bit of difference. As the country boy said, it ain't going to make a hill of beans. You have to be country to understand what that means. Ain't gonna make a hill of beans. Listen to me, it ain't gonna make a bit of difference. It ain't gonna make a bit of difference because the church is the one that God has empowered to change the social and moral evils of a society. It was a few people praying in Rhode Island, one of my relatives, in 1657, crying out for Pentecost on this nation that began to set the precedence of Pentecost in this nation. They brought down the stronghold of the Puritan domination in the colonies, in the Massachusetts colonies. Hallelujah. A Pentecost did. It brought down that religious thing. It did. And then another wave came when more people came together and began to grab a hold of the things of the Spirit in the early 1700s, and by the mid-1700s, an awakening had begun to sweep the United States of America, and out of that came a constitution, and God raised up a political system that had never existed before out of a revival. And then God brought forth another awakening and another awakening. And every time there was any kind of move of the Spirit, there were more freedoms that came, liberties that came, injustices were rolled back. But now things have slipped, and more injustice exists than ever before in unique and different ways. While there seems to be more freedoms in certain areas, there's more injustice in others. And the only thing that's going to make a difference as you and I begin to function in the heavenly realm that we've been empowered in function in, where we see Father and we talk to Him, and whatever we bind on earth, He binds in heaven. Whatever we loose on earth, He looses in heaven. Where we begin to go with authority, make disciples out of nations. You understand this. Listen to me. The church decides the spiritual condition of the government. If the church decides the spiritual condition of the government, because we're the hinderer of iniquity. We have been given power to make disciples out of nation, and that's not some kind of a legislative, dictatorial theocracy. It is the spiritual state of the heart of the church, of how the church is walking in purity, and the church is walking in holiness, and the church is walking in obedience to the living God, and living out the authority of the life that we've been given by the Holy Ghost in Christ Jesus. And when that's not happening, then suddenly what happens is a nation begins to be overrun by the demon spirits that overran the church in its disobedience. And so this is where we're at. The church itself accepted a progressive liberal agenda. So the government accepts a progressive liberal agenda. But Father's going to turn it around, because there's going to be people like you and me who are going to hook up with Him, and we're going to do it His way. And we're going to fight the battles. We're going to fight the battles of the mind. We're going to fight the battles of the thoughts. We're going to fight the battles of persecution. We're going to fight the battles of circumstances. We're going to fight the battles of things that press against us right out of a demon realm. I recognize when it's circumstances where it's a demon realm. I recognize, and it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter which one they are. You don't have to parse them out. You don't have to discern the differences. If it's not the good word of God, you don't accept it. You don't agree with it. You don't speak it. You don't allow it to work in your thinking. And one of the most important things to do, people, to keep yourself in a place where you are just absolutely
protected. It's just to walk in God's love and walk in humility. Just walk in divine love. Love will make you the servant of everyone. Love will cause you to, you know, esteem everybody better than yourself. Love ain't going to get there and give them have no pointed fingers of accusation. Walk in humility. Be clothed with humility and walk in love is the greatest place of a greatest posture. And for me, and you know, I don't describe the weapons of our warfare any differently, or even the armament of God any differently. For me, the armament of God, of righteousness, is walking in humility and love. It's walking in lowliness and meekness, that this is a divine armor of protection. Hallelujah. Here's what the Lord, I hear the Lord saying all the time. He's calling us up. He's saying, He said, come live in heaven. Come live in this heavenly realm. Tell the people to live in a heavenly realm. Tell the people, in other words, to walk in the Spirit. Live in a heavenly realm. Tell the people to be led by the Spirit. In other words, live in a heavenly realm. Tell the people to desire the spiritual. In other words, desire the heavenly. Tell the people to step on into the holies of holies and don't go out. In other words, step into a heavenly realm. Come and behold Him. Come be seated with Him. Come walk here in this realm of divine empowerment. This realm of divine glory. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. There's everything around you is opposed to that. Everything in this culture is opposed to that. Deal with it.
Amen.
And when you begin to deal with it, you begin to get hungry for this thing. So I'm going to tell you right now, you won't be in church every night.
Amen.
You won't be in church every night.
Yeah.
Because it keeps you thinking right.
Yeah.
Keeps you stirred up.
Yeah.
As you think right, as you're stirred up in the things of the Spirit, faith grows. As you live and meditate on the Word, faith grows. As you worship and praise God and give yourself to the things of the Spirit, faith grows.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I am ready to move with the sovereign movings of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The encounters with God results in seeing who's going to follow on to pursue Him, who will passionately pursue Him. Hallelujah. It prepares us to move with Him when He comes to us as the early and the latter rain. If at any moment in time the enemy starts lying to you and tells you you've lost out, you've left out, you've missed out, you blew it, you can't get in, it's too late, start laughing. Just laugh. Just laugh. Just rejoice. And let your laughter begin to rise up in praise and shouts at the Ancient of Days. Hallelujah. That's what they said about Lazarus. Then he came walking out, you know. More people turned to Jesus because of Lazarus. Did you know that? Than even because of Jesus. Did you know that? More people started believing Jesus was Messiah because of Lazarus' testimony than Jesus' own personal impact. What a ministry. All you do is just stand up in the room. There's the guy that was dead. He was dead for like 4 days. Then you get up and you start telling how you died. This is your testimony. Not how bad of a guy you were or whatever, but how that you like died. And how that you went into the place of the departed spirits and everybody's like, And how that you begin to start telling about the realms of the unseen and the reality of eternity, and then how that there in that place of the departed saints, you heard the voice and the cry of Jesus come to you as He cried out over the the realms of space and time where his voice is heard throughout all eternity. As he called forth your name, and suddenly you were drawn out back into your body. And you woke up all wrapped up in your body. You woke up in your body all wrapped up in napkins and whatnot. And all the things that he would have told about in his testimony, my goodness, I'm telling you right now, that would have been a Holy Ghost meeting. I'm telling you, everybody would have been on their face crying out to God, getting baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, repenting. And that's what was happening. I'll tell you right now, that's what I'm making my point is, even if you're dead, it ain't necessarily over. It could be just the beginning of your ministry.
Right.
It could be setting you up for the beginning of your ministry, because God is a miracle worker, how he gets us in position. He just wants us to start agreeing with him. That's... He just wants us to start agreeing. I doubtless will come to vision and revelation. And I want you to start saying that too. I will not come the least bit behind in any of the gifts. And I want you to start saying that too. I'm going to tell you, his grace that has been given to me will not be poured out upon me in vain. I'm going to run with it. I'm going to labor more than them all. I'm going to fight the fight. I'm going to give myself wholly to these things. Wholly to these things. And I want you to say that too. Because I tell you, God is here, and he beholds, and he desires to flood our lives with all his divine power and all his divine glory. He desires to have his witnesses in the earth that glorify the name of his only begotten Son. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The other day I was preaching in this church, and the pastor said, "Man, did you know your eyes turned colors? Your eyes change colors when you start talking like that." I'm thinking, just wait until my face lights up. I'm going for everything. I want to go for everything that is available in Christ Jesus being manifested in my life. Not me being seen and me being revealed, me coming to something great, but the Lord Jesus Christ having total liberty to take fully over everything about my life, everything about my expression, everything about my thoughts, everything about my actions, everything about my thinking, that Christ Jesus, the Son of God, may be revealed in me. And I pray in the name of Jesus, you'll lay hold on this. This is laying hold on eternal life. That life is Jesus Christ. Eternal life is personified as him. Don't you let Satan come out with his lying, cheating, stealing works and steal from you this great authority and this great anointing and this great power that God has given you, these great riches that are yours. Don't you let his cheap tricks take you. Walk in wisdom and insight and revelation in Jesus' mighty name. I want to finish here with Colossians chapter 3. And if you've not memorized these scriptures tonight, I've just given you a few. Do so. Let them become proclamations to you. There were things that I started speaking because God had led me through fasting and prayer to only pray his word. And I started praying and speaking things. Much of the verses of scripture that I memorized, prayed them. Just prayers. And I promise you that if you begin to start praying God to God, his word, and thanking him for what he said, and you take all of those verses of scriptures and you apply them personally to your life, and you begin to thank God that this is who you are in him. And this is what he's done in you. And that he's perfecting it and fully establishing it. I remember 35 years ago sitting around with people saying, "Oh, you know, we just really want to see the signs and the wonders and the miracles. Where are the great signs and wonders and miracles of God?" They took off and went in different directions. They didn't stay around long enough to see the signs and wonders and miracles. They didn't stay around long enough to go with us to the different places that God has sent us over the years to see great masses of souls come into the kingdom and exploits. They just want to sit around and talk about it and wonder why and live in a hypothetical and talk about what they weren't seeing, get all carried away with doubt. I pressed in. And I'm saying to you tonight, you press in. You lay hold on these things. You lay hold on these things. They're yours. You lay hold on them. You accept what God has declared. You agree with what God has declared about you. You begin to live out the kind of life that He says is yours. You get up in the morning, you get baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. You get somebody say, how often do I need to be filled? The Lord says, continually be filled, speaking to yourself, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourself in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. You need to be baptized afresh as soon as the psalm, hymn, and the spiritual song seems to cease. That's your indicator. Get baptized again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give yourself more to praying in the Spirit, praying in the Holy Ghost. There's a great transition there because if you'll keep yourself in the love of God, you'll begin to know something that causes you to step into all the fullness of God. Understand me. Understand what I'm telling you. To know the love of Christ, which passes understanding, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. That's why Jude said, build yourself up in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keeping yourself in the love of God. Faith that works by love, this love that unveils the whole of the fullness of God. Listen to me, right there in that place of participating with until it becomes something you can't shut down, until it becomes something that is a rushing mighty wind, until it's something like rivers that sweep you away into the current of His glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was in a place not too long ago and I was introduced and there was other preachers there and someone said, well, you know, so-and-so's been here and he's like a sniper. He just sits, waits, camouflages and takes you. He says, now the 50 millimeter is coming. As he was introducing me and I thought, man, I don't know if he meant that as a compliment or what, but I feel so blessed that I am likened unto a 50 millimeter caliber machine gun because I'm taking everybody out in this place tonight. A sniper might have got one or two, but a 50 millimeter caliber fully loaded with unlimited amount of bullets, I'm telling you right now, there is nothing left standing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ. You know, somebody starts telling us that we have full-on nuclear arsenal. Amen. Amen. This place is about to go up in a gigantic flume of fire. That's you and me. Why? Because we have that glory. We have the Borospina, that same song. We have the Globothetena. We have the Firstipuramaste. Dunamis is an explosive, which is the Greek word for power. Dunamis is an explosive, unlimited explosive power that encapsulates the divine power
an ability that we have been given in God, and it's ours right now. And He's developing us and training us. And if we give ourselves to His training, then what we're going to have is everything He described in His Word. And the more we give ourselves solely unto Him, consecrated just to be taught by Him, to be good at this, then the faster we cross over into the realms of those divine exploits and of power and authority that God wants to see. Manifested as a witness of His love to a lost and dying world. So we read in Colossians chapter 3. Listen to what we read. Here's what He says. He says this. If you be risen with Christ. Risen up into what? An earthly, worldly, common, ordinary, human existence? What on earth are we talking about? I am risen up into a divine life, heir of God, co-heir with Christ Jesus, risen up into a realm in which God the Holy Spirit comes to me without limitation and without reservation, because the blood has made me everything holy and acceptable to God. I'm risen into a divine existence in Christ Jesus, which is absolutely, by definition, purely heavenly. Purely, we are inviting you to come into the heavenly, to live out your life in the heavenly, to live right now in the realms of the heavenly, to live right now in the life of Christ Jesus, which is the life divine. This is what God has called us to do. This is our existence in Him. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. But it's not me, it's Christ Jesus that is alive and lives here. Because Jesus wasn't just crucified, He was also raised from the dead. He was not just raised from the dead, He ascended up on high. Hallelujah. And now is coronated and crowned King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the absolute sovereign power over all principalities and powers and might and dominion. And we are seated together with Him in that power, in that authority. And I will not in any ways abdicate, dilute it, or make it in any way less than what God has established it to be. My confession will be His declaration, which He's revealed in His Word. And I pray in the name of Jesus tonight, every one of you, if you are risen with Christ, then seek those things which are above. Seek those things which are in the realms of the heavenly, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Say, Christ is seated at the right hand of God. And I am seated together with Him there. If you did nothing but just memorize the five verses of Scripture that I've given you tonight, and you say, Lord, I'm going to agree with You. I'm going to believe You. I'm going to live this. I'm going to practice this. This is the way it's going to be. I don't care what comes along and says it's different. I don't care if an angel comes, a circumstance, a thought. It does not matter to me. Any assailing situation, I'm going to agree with You, God. Everything in your life will be changed inside of a year. Inside of a year. You will have fought battles that you did not even know exist, that you had already been. You lay down to every time they come to you because you don't even have a discernment to recognize what's going on. But suddenly the Word gives you a discernment. Because you lay hold on the Word, you start living the Word, suddenly you begin to deal with the challenges and the crisis. Hallelujah. Come on. I want to be happy. I don't want to be too sad. Lower it a little bit. Hallelujah. I like that. I like that part that, you know, hallelujah. Joyful, love, rest, praise God, peace, and all the rest. Huh? Come on now. Come on now. Come on. I'm going to get, I want to get all excited. Come on. Come on, people. You know what? When you stay in happy land, turn it down a little bit. When you stay in happy land, it's hard to go over it. You just won't want anything else. Thank you, Jesus. Set your affections on things above. What are we talking about? The heavenly. Things above is just a synonym. It's an expression for the heavenly. Set your affections on things above. You've risen with Christ. You've been risen with Christ. Seek the heavenly. There's no difference between seeking the heavenly and seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Jesus said, above all other things, seek the kingdom. Seek the kingdom of God. Jesus said, if I come to you and I cast out devils by the Spirit, then the kingdom of God has come to you.
Yeah.
If you begin to function in miracles, you're going after the kingdom of God, you're going after the display of the power of God, the glory of God. These signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They will cast out devils. Jesus said, if I cast out devils and work miracles by the Spirit, then the kingdom of God has come to you. These signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They'll cast out devils.
Amen.
They'll speak with his new tongue.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to seek the heavenly. I'm going to set my affections on the heavenly. Not on earthly things. Examine yourself. Examine yourself right now. How much of your affection is on earthly? How many shiny things captivate you? Huh? How many earthly interests captivate your attention? Think about it. Think about it. Understand there's a practical application. Said, no, I don't want that. Lord, I want you. I want the true riches. No, I don't want that. Father, I'm interested in that which does not fade away, that which is not temporal, that which does not perish with the using. I'm interested, Lord. My interest is not in food that is just going to sustain me for a while. I'm interested in manna, heavenly bread,
yes.
Bread of life.
Yes.
I'm not going to seek that thing. I'm not going to seek temporal things. I'm going to seek you, and I'm going to let you add all the rest of this to me. I'm going to let you take care of me. Hear this, for you are dead. Say, I'm dead.
I'm dead.
Say, I've lost my life.
I've lost my life.
And found His.
And found His.
He said, you're dead and your life is hid away with Christ.
Amen.
In God.
Amen.
You can't see me, I'm hid away in Jesus. Find and seek. Or seek and find, rather. Seek and find. Go looking for me, you can't see me, I'm hid away in Jesus. I'm going to talk like Jesus, I'm going to act like Jesus, I'm going to preach like Jesus, I'm going to move like Jesus, I'm going to walk like Jesus. I'm going to love like Jesus. I'm going to get aggravated with religion like Jesus. Then, when Christ, who is your life, He is my life. Christ is my life. That's why I'm in church all the time.
Amen.
People say, oh, I love God and He loves me and I pray all the time. They don't go to church. You're a liar. Truth's not in you. You're not hungry and thirsty. There's no proofs in your life. There's no evidence that you've been born again. And that's the first epistle of John is all about proofs and evidence. It's His proofs and His evidence. It's His examination. It's about time people speak up. Here's what Father is looking for. Father is looking for a radical call of His people to a place of purity and holiness and consecration. And there He said, He will unveil to us and reveal to us and provide an entrance for us abundantly into the everlasting kingdom. kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. There's a realm of existence now. That is, 1 Peter or 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 10 is not in any way in contradiction to Colossians 1:13. They're both the same. One is talking to us about an event that took place through salvation when we were born again and made one with God, and we became heirs and co-inheritors with Christ Jesus, He and us and we in Him. And then the other is talking about a realm that we now begin to mature into, where we lay hold on the dimensions of all the authority and power of God that has been given to us and know how to function and operate in it. Everybody stand with me. Hallelujah. I'm gonna do this. I'm walking around heavenly. I know angels are here right now. I know Holy Ghost is here. Turn this up here. You got it way loud out here. I can't even hear myself up here at all. Turn it down a little bit. I can't even hear what I'm saying. You guys have got to figure all that stuff out. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Everybody just lift your hands towards heaven. It is impossible to be loved by God more than He loves you now. He loves you so much. Father loves you so much. He's just looking for some people who will love Him enough to agree with Him, to move with Him, to go where He goes, to do what He does, to be led by the Spirit, to walk in the Spirit, to say, Lord Jesus, I know You're here. You know, that is a huge challenge in many respects in growing in God all by itself. Because in all the hustle and all the turmoil and all the crisis and all the things that we're supposedly doing for the kingdom of God or for whatever reasons, for responsibility, we can be overwhelmed with the task. You just need to recognize, wait a minute, Jesus is here. Lord Jesus, I thank You that You're here. Sometimes we were driving home from church when Joshua was a little guy, and he says, well, Dad, what if we went off the side of the mountain? I said, son, we won't. Jesus is in the car. He's here. He's with us. And if we did, we would fly because He's in the car. We're good. We're taken care of. He's my remedy. He's my answer. He's my solution. He's the supplier of my need. He's my comfort. He's my certainty. He's my confidence that whatever's going on is we're going to be good. There's going to be just nothing but promotion here in Jesus' name. Yes. Hallelujah. Right now, if there's anybody in this place at this moment and at this time, you do not know Jesus Christ, you are uncertain as to whether or not your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you're uncertain as to whether or not He lives with you, who abides in you, you're uncertain whether or not this authority is really yours, this life is really yours, you're uncertain as to whether or not you experienced the change that the Bible describes, that the miracle of salvation is given. God, the Holy Ghost, is here to bring you certainty. He's here to make you certain of these things. He's here to change everything, to make everything new, and you embrace the newness. Before it gets winter time, we have to do a baptism. And so there are some people here that haven't been baptized. They're maybe not there. I don't know if there's anyone here tonight. I know there's people that are here in the ministry right now that have given their life to Jesus and they haven't been baptized yet. But what we're going to do is next Sunday. That's going to work, right, baby? Huh? Is that a yes or is that a no? She has the calendar. What's wrong? You're going, any time will work. Okay, so at any rate, on Sunday, this coming Sunday, because sometimes I say it and then after the meeting, she tells me all the reasons why we can't do it. It's like, okay, here we are. Praise God, it will work on Sunday. But at any rate, this Sunday, between services, we are going to have a baptism. Praise God. We're going to take everybody who needs to be baptized. You've never been baptized. Because, and I want to talk to you right now, just real quickly, I want to talk to you. There are so many people who've given their life to Jesus, and you've genuinely been touched by the Lord, and He loves you, but you've never really fully accepted it. And you always keep coming back and uncertain and wondering. All that is a browbeaten, lying demon spirit's condemning you, and you need to stand up to it and punch it in the nose. No, I'm gonna take that back. You need to take the sword of the Spirit and cut its stinking head off. Hallelujah. No, I only say that because I remember that all the big bullies, all you had to do is break their nose and it was done. They're like, oh, I messed up. My nose is broke, you know, right? Forget it, it's done. So, but you know what? It's better to just go in with the sword of the Spirit, take the head. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Do not be in that condemnation any longer. Do not be in that condemnation any longer. God wants to make you certain. And you know, if you've gone to the water and you've been baptized, the Lord, there's something that the Lord does to seal us there. And, you know, I know a lot of people who come and accepted Jesus, that come to the altar, especially, you know, people of Hinduism or Buddhism or another religion, Islam, Judaism, and they'll come to the altar and they'll come and they'll sing and they'll be part of church. But if you want to baptize them, they don't want to be baptized. Because it really does. It really seals the decision. It's something that is important. People act like it's not important. It's important. And once you've dealt with a number of Muslims and Hindus, people of other religions, suddenly you begin to see that there's a sorting out that goes on there. And if you've never been baptized, you're here tonight, you're watching me by the web, Sunday between services, we're going to take you and we're going to push you down into the water. Hallelujah. And we go right out to Torrey Pines State Beach, right out there where everybody's at. Don't matter how big the waves are, we got you. Praise God. No wetsuits allowed. God's going to give you warmth. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. God is so good. The choice is ours. Heaven or hell. Life or death. Blessings or curses. Truth or lying. God or Satan. This guy who's the head of the Satanic Church, I don't even know what his name is. His weird name, I don't even want to repeat it. There are too many people repeating his name. He said at least Satan's got all the Christians worshiping him, or many Christians worshiping him one day out of the year. And he's referring to Halloween. You know, and I just bring that out just because there are so many things vying for your affections, vying for your agreement, vying for your attention. I think it's a harmless little stupid spook show. I'm really. I think it's a harmless stupid spook show. But you know, if they want to try to claim it like that it's really something big deal, I mean, that's weird. It even makes it even weirder. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? Oh, Jesus. They made the scary little pumpkin faces to scare the demons off. No, they did. That's what pagan religions do. They make scary faces so that the demons will be scared and leave them alone. What a theology. What a demonology, I should say. Jesus help us.
people come into heaven, be clothed with His majesty and be clothed with His glory. Be baptized in His fire. Be baptized in His presence. Go ahead and give yourself completely over to God. He loves you so much. From this day forward, in the name of Jesus Christ, you will not be held back from anything that God has for you. I put a blessing on you. I release you from every tormenting, lying thing of hell, every lie, every shame, every condemnation. You go free in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. You go free. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.